So we want to thank everyone for joining us. My name is Nydia Duenas, and I am the Dean of Students and Diversity Affairs at Southwestern Law School, and I am also a proud alum. Diversity Day is one of my favorite events because it allows us to showcase what makes Southwestern such a special place. Our students come from varied backgrounds with an array of legal interests that for many have been influenced by their life experiences and have motivated them to attend law school. The experiences of our student body, the scholarship of our faculty, and the many opportunities such as our clinics and externships, Southwestern, an amazing place to study the law. From many of our students about that later today. Because of the different programs Southwestern offers, be it our two-year accelerated scale program, our redesigned evening program, or our program for students with childcare or elder care responsibilities, this is a place that strives to make a legal education accessible for all. Hope is that today you'll leave learning a bit more about what makes our law school special, and most importantly, that you'll leave feeling inspired. I also have the distinguished pleasure of introducing our dean, Dean Susan Westerberg Prager. Now that I have worked with Dean Susan long enough to know that she does not like long introductions, I'll try to keep this short. But what I will say about our dean is that she came to Southwestern at a time in her career that she could have gone on to be the dean at any law school in the country. She came to Southwestern in 2013 after serving as executive director and CEO of the Association of American Law Schools, the AALS. And earlier in her career, she was the first woman law dean in the UC system and one of only two women in that capacity in the entire country at the time. She is the longest serving law dean in UCLA history to date. But we had the good fortune of Dean Susan choosing to come to Southwestern, and I am sure in a moment here she will tell you all about why that was. But in my time working closely with her, she has been a champion for making the legal profession a more inclusive place. She has promoted many women, me included, to dean positions, also including two women vice deans. This is important because we know that representation matters. And under her leadership, the evening program was reimagined to make law school more accessible for working students. She has also been an advocate for maintaining course offerings in the morning time slot so that students with childcare or elder care responsibilities can balance those and attend law school. And most recently, in the wake of a tumultuous year where the social injustice faced by Black Americans was front and center again, and the racial and social economic disparities by COVID-19 were becoming very clear in our communities, she had the foresight to know that the administration does not have all of the answers, but that we need to continuously strive to better support our students and to make Southwestern a more inclusive place. So Dean Susan put together the Dean's Task Force for Equity, Inclusion, and Belonging, a committee comprised of students, faculty, staff, and alumni to advise her on issues impacting our community members. The Dean's Task Force has created an invaluable resource for the law school and highlights what makes Dean Susan such a special dean and a wonderful colleague to work alongside. Without further delay, here is Dean Susan. Thank you.
Thank you, Nydia. It's wonderful to work with so many superb people at Southwestern. As we all know, we don't do our jobs alone, and the collaborative spirit of the place is so strong and so effective. It's really exciting to welcome you all to our first, and I hope our only, virtual execution of Diversity Day. This is an important event for current students and for those of you thinking about law school. There are so many reasons why I have loved Southwestern. And Dean Duenas has already mentioned one of them, and that is our students. When I was thinking about creating this task force, my confidence level in our students was so high that I appointed more students to this task force than I would have normally done. Their maturity, their constructive nature, their drive to help Southwestern become better and to help the surrounding community become better was so strong, and I've not been disappointed. Our students on the task force have been among our very strongest members, and their drive and devotion has not diminished. Our students have been spectacular in another way recently. We just got bar results from the twice postponed California bar exam, and Southwestern graduates this time passed at, I think, the highest rate in our modern history, nearly 85%. That is so remarkable given all of the uncertainties and the fact that their final 4 to 5 weeks of law school was suddenly distanced, that the bar exam was uncertain all along, first to be at the end of July, then in early September, then October. But they stayed the course, they worked hard, and their success was really driven by the fact that such a large percentage of them did all the work that our outstanding bar preparation staff asked them to do and indicated to them would make a difference. And it certainly, certainly did. We've also had, I think, the strongest group of student leaders that I've ever seen in my now more than two decades as a dean in two institutions at two very different times. Our leadership has been so helpful, so constructive, constantly feeding to us ideas of things that we could do that we weren't doing, things that we could do differently, things we were doing well. These people are going to make superb lawyers in whatever they choose to do, whether it is directly practicing law or doing something else. Our faculty were also just incredible. Think about this. Many of us of advanced age, not any of them as advanced as I am, but they had to turn in 5 days from in-class instruction to Zoom, something that most of us had never used before, but lots of Southwestern faculty had been experimenting with distance methods, and we had already implemented them for a portion of our evening program to try to make the evening more doable for people, given the ever-lengthening time associated with commuting in Los Angeles. So we had some colleagues who really were excited by the potential of the technology and who were so generous in helping others. And we, together with our students, did it. Vice Dean Weissman, who is here and you'll meet later today, made sure that faculty were supported over the summer to improve what they were doing. And many faculty diverted their summer to redesigning their courses as well. None of us thought it would be this long, but given particularly our challenges in California, we are accepting of the fact that in the best possible case, we think we can begin again in person in August, but we appreciate that not everyone will be able to do that because of their particular health conditions. So we're exploring how we might manage all this. Now, the third component of this terrific place, and this is a faculty that cares a lot about teaching. It's not that there aren't very important scholars on the faculty, but we have more than our fair share of people who do it all, serve the school magnificently, are superb teachers in and out of the classroom, great mentors to students, and doing important research and scholarship. But our third component is our alums. I have never seen an institution where alums care so much about current students. And I think this runs through the decades of graduates. It's not a new phenomenon, it's not an old phenomenon, it is consistent. And part of it is that I think that Southwestern people want to remain connected. And they know that students will face challenges and they want to be helpful. So take advantage of them when you're in law school. Make sure that you've really internalized that these people wouldn't be offering their services unless they really wanted to do it, enjoyed it, and felt rewarded by it. So don't hang back. Create meaningful conversations. We're not talking about a cocktail party where you're meeting someone and shaking hands and having a conversation that's interrupted a minute later. It's about learning from them about the practice of law, getting their ideas about how you could get more tastes of practical training in addition to those that we offer in the curriculum. And it's about drawing on them for advice when you're feeling overwhelmed as well. My hope is that today you will get a feel for how diversity isn't some separate thing that we set aside at Southwestern. It is integral to who we are. It is infused not only in the history of our institution, it's very much a critical part of our present. And as Dean Duenas said, it is one of the principal reasons that I chose to come to Southwestern. Southwestern is a place that achieves diversity without engaging in affirmative action, a place that truly values this diversity. And perhaps that is in significant part because of our remarkable history. So with respect to our present, we're regularly ranked in the top 10 or 11% of all US ABA approved law schools for diversity. That typically means that we're in the top 20 institutions in that respect. This class, this entering class is now approximately 47% racially diverse. The class was over 60% female, and 45% of the students were first generation, meaning that they're the first in their family to go to college, let alone graduate school. So our present is a reality of diversity, and diversity is part of strength. When we look at our history, I have to relate that our founder was a man only in his 20s, and he saw that Los Angeles was going to grow. I'm talking about the period before World War I. In 1911, he decides to start an educational institution that was non-traditional for its time. It was designed to supply people who could help further LA's growth. And he had in mind that the business community was going to have to grow. So he had a law school, an accounting department. Then there were people called secretaries assisting business people and lawyers. So there was a secretarial school. And later in its history, Southwestern became only a law school. But when he thought about how the school would be structured, he said there will be a day program for people who work at night, and there will be a night program for people who work during the day. And that has continued at our law school for our entire history. He also made clear that he believed that anyone who had the intellectual capacity and the drive to go to law school should be able to do that. Well, that sounds a lot more normal today, but it was not normal then. For those of you who have studied US history, you know that the period surrounding World War I was one of tremendous anti-immigrant feelings. Our first graduate was a woman, At the time she graduated in 1915, she could not vote in a federal election. Women could not vote in federal elections, but she became a lawyer thanks to Southwestern. It was a time of growing racist attitudes. The history of the treatment of the Chinese in California in the 19th century is well known. After the First Nations immigration law was passed because of anti-Chinese sentiments emanating from the West Coast, and that immigration stream was constricted, Japanese began coming to California. And during Southwestern's first decade, anti-Japanese sentiment in California was growing. There were two pieces of legislation in the California legislature called the Alien Land Laws, designed to prevent Japanese from owning land. And this was in part driven by others in California who were farming and were distressed by the effectiveness of the Japanese at farming. I could go on and on with respect to these details, but I also want to mention that discrimination against Spanish-speaking people has always seemed so ironic to me because of our original constitution and the deference that it paid to the Spanish-speaking Californians. And of course, we all know the national phenomenon and the persistence of racism focused on Black Americans. So these are important topics. And in our history, Southwestern counts things like the first female public defender in the nation, the first African-American female judge in California. And when she was appointed, she was only one of three such people in the entire country. It was the early 1960s, and Jerry Brown's father, Pat Brown, appointed her. The first African-American state appellate court justice in the nation is Arlie Woods, Southwestern alum, who chaired our board of trustees for a decade and only left the board a few years ago. An extraordinary woman who prides herself, and as she puts it, she became the first female Black partner in a majority law firm in Los Angeles. She and Vano Spencer, that first Black female trial judge in California, graduated from Southwestern in the 50s, only a year apart. And they both became presiding justices of the California Court of Appeal and had very long service in those roles. Our graduates include the first Latina trial court judge in the entire nation, the first Chinese American federal district judge in the continental United States. He is still very much active and cares greatly about Southwestern, the first Native American judge in California, and of course, so many more, but the final one I want to mention is Los Angeles's longest serving and only African American mayor, Tom Bradley, who came to Southwestern's evening program while he was working LAPD as a police officer during the day, coming to law school at night. At the time he joined LAPD, he could only be assigned to work with another Black officer. Well, we're proud of this history, but we want you all to keep making that history, and we know that you will. The State Bar has recognized Southwestern for its outstanding efforts in diversity with an award made to organizations that have promoted diversity in the legal profession. That award's been given for about 16 years now, and we are the only law school to have received it. For 2 years in a row recently, Southwestern received an LSAC Diversity Matters Award for promoting legal education to underrepresented communities within the legal profession. So my hope is that, among other things, you'll leave here today with a strong sense that diversity isn't a tagline. It's not something we treat casually. It is something that is an indelible part of our history and a vital part of our present. So I hope, of course, that many of you will decide to choose to come to law school at Southwestern. I don't think you'll be disappointed. I have come to love the place very, very deeply. And one of the most exciting things that's happened to us recently is something that happened in part because of our students. Through our students, a professor named Kevin Green learned about Southwestern because our entertainment students have invited him over the years to speak to the Entertainment Law Society. Kevin joined us a couple of months ago and is teaching his first two Southwestern classes this term, contracts, and the offering in the first year elective, focusing on copyright. He has himself an extraordinary background. He was born in Jamaica, Queens, New York. He's a Marine Corps veteran, and he's a Yale Law School graduate. He was a Wall Street lawyer at firms that people in corporate law know are among the best anywhere. And he decided to enter law teaching and ventured to California. And like many people who taste California, they decide not to leave. Fortunately for us, Kevin decided not to leave. Over his years as an academic, he has written in the intellectual property field. He very creatively, as you will see, applied critical race theory to a phenomenon in music law. And as you will also see, music is his love, as well as his professional focus. He is well sought after by practicing lawyers to serve as an expert witness in their cases. So his fame has spread, and it is such an honor that he has decided to come to Southwestern. He is one of those faculty that, and there are some others on this call, I'm looking at them, who can do it all, who's great in their service commitments to the school, just superb teacher and mentor to students, and who is a scholar who helps his profession and who will help Southwestern send the message that we're serious about all three of these realms. So it is my honor to introduce Kevin, who now holds an endowed chair at Southwestern, the chair that the trustees named for our founder, John Schumacher. Kevin, take it away.
Wow. Thank you, Dean Prager, for that overly generous introduction. And of course, I have some slides here I'm going to share to kind of keep me on track. So let's start it from the beginning.
I'm sure the slides have sound too.
Yes. I need to get here to start the show. Let's see. Look, it's blocking me from starting the show. Okay, can you see my slides? Can you guys see them?
You can see the main PowerPoint window.
What's that?
It hasn't started like the slideshow.
We can see the title and the House.
I want to
get
rid of this tab on top because it's not letting me get to the slideshow part of it because there's a tab on top.
Oh, you should be able to drag that away.
Okay, how's that?
You can see them on the left now.
It's still not in present mode.
Started from the beginning. And let me try to share it again. This way. All right, is that better?
Yes, that's better.
Yes, that's perfect.
Okay, great. So I'm gonna talk about the copyright House of Horrors, which is the title of my book, which is almost finished, right? I'm hoping it will come out this year. But before I do that, let's just scroll down here. What's wrong with this thing? I just wanted to thank Southwestern. I want to thank Dean Prager, who is an icon in legal education. I mean, known all around the country, if not all around the world, and for giving me the opportunity to come to Southwestern. She talked about excited. I mean, I'm so excited to be at Southwestern and really looking forward to when we open and we can do all this live. I also want to appreciate our admissions office who put this together with Nancy and Lisa and Nydia and Robert and the rest of the team. So thanks so much for inviting me to speak. As you can see, there's Southwestern Law School. It looks like that was a beautiful kind of almost cafe setup. So I'm really looking forward to that time when we can do that again, right? All in person. So let me tell you a little bit about my work. And of course, it's germane because we now have this new awakening, right? And it's a perfect time to really address issues that should have been addressed a long time ago. Now, more than 20 years ago, I started talking about the role of intellectual property in people of color, and particularly African Americans. And when I started this work, no one else was talking about that at all. And so I was this I don't want to say this outcast, but almost, right, in the legal academy. And now, I mean, it's come full circle. People now are really willing to focus on these issues, particularly in the intellectual property space. And that's what I want to talk about today. Of course, here's Dr. King, and he did his I Have a Dream speech, but that's also a copyright case. And the way copyright law worked at that time, he almost lost the rights to that speech. And let's take a little listen to
it. I am happy to join with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. Five score years ago, a great American in whose symbolic shadow we stand today signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope for millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 100 years later, the Negro still is not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. 100 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. 100 years later, Negro is still languished in the corners of American society. finds himself in exile in his own land. So we've come here today to dramatize a shameful condition. In a sense, we've come to our nation's capital to cash a check. When the architects of our republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, they were signing a promissory note to which every American was to fall heir. This note was a promise that all men, yes, black men as well as white men, would be guaranteed the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It is obvious today that America has defaulted on this promissory note insofar as her citizens of color are concerned. Instead of honoring this sacred obligation, America has given the Negro people a bad check, a check which has come back marked insufficient funds.
So that's Dr. King. That took a little bit, but I thought it was worth hearing. That's the beginning of the dream speech in DC. And this metaphor of a bad check is so apt to the intellectual property world, and particularly copyright, which I'm going to talk about today. The reason we have copyright law is to increase the stream of creative works in society, but also to incentivize and reward authors. And the first part in terms of African-American authors is a job well done. No group, certainly in the music space, more creative than African-American authors, from the blues to jazz, to ragtime, to rock and roll, all the way up to today, hip hop, the most popular music, not only in the United States, but globally. And so my work was really looking at it. It was how is that people who are so creative and gave so much creative works to American society receive so little out of it and often nothing out of it? And that's the question I've been exploring, and going forward, what we can do about that. So that's what I wanted to share with you today. Of course, the people who created the blues aren't that much different. And I talk about this in an article that's going to be published this year in the Journal of the Copyright Society about copyright terminations. And it's about hip hop and terminations. But of course, the people who created the blues aren't much different from the people in the inner city today who are making hip hop. Legally unsophisticated, often illiterate. And of course, we have this very complex copyright system, which requires all these different formalities, registration, publication, deposit, notice. It actually wreaked havoc on African-American creative communities. And my work explores that in a lot of detail over many years. I talk about copyright's seven deadly sins. And maybe that's just a cute way. There's probably more than seven, but all these various doctrines kind of conspired to keep the wealth, the tremendous wealth that all this music has created out of the hands of the people who created it, right? And so The Lion Sleeps Tonight, which you probably all remember. So the Wimbawe part of that actually is an African melody that was created by a Zulu tribe back in the 1920s called Solomon Linda. And he never received anything for that. He signed it away for like the equivalent of a US dollar. Meanwhile, Disney made millions of that using it in The Lion King. Finally, about 10 years ago, they ended up paying out the heirs who were literally living on dirt floors in South Africa. Meanwhile, this music is generating all this wealth. This is a kind of copyright history 101, but it's the untalked about history, right? The unexplored history of how copyright law particularly can affect communities of color. All of these various things, fixation, the fact that it had to be written down, right, in the copyright or fixed in some form. And I could go through the rest of them in the interest of time, but I'll probably talk about it through the lens of my book here shortly to make it a little bit more concrete. Of course, the other part of it is that if you have a copyright, you can't really make any money unless you make a deal with someone. So the copyright contract connection has also been devastating to these communities of color. And over there on the right-hand side, you see where it says PPX. That is one of the most infamous contracts in music history. It was Jimi Hendrix's PPX contract. Hendrix, the god of rock and roll. In that contract in 1965, he agreed to sign away all of his music, everything he created from 1965 to 1970. He didn't make it to 1970 because he died before then, for the princely sum of $1 and a 1% royalty rate. And that thing ended up litigated for the next 20 years, long after he was done. But this is the American music history business. And of course, people often say, well, yes, the white artists were also mistreated. And they also, the Beatles signed a terrible contract, their first contract. But the difference was that there in that period, there were things called race record labels. And the contracts were different. If you were African-American and you signed with a label, you got a very different contract than someone who was white. Say, why do we care about this? Because that was actually 1965, Jimi Hendrix. He completely shook up rock and roll. He changed every way that we think about it without him. Well, all of that stuff is still under copyright, if you understand how copyright works. Actually, everything that's before 1925 is still under copyright in the United States. You have to understand this. So this stuff is all still making money and people are getting rich on it. Now, of course, the Hendrix estate was smart and they were able to secure his rights. So they were actually a success story. They control those rights, but many of them don't. Of course, this is the public domain, which if time permits at the end, I have a little poem about it, about the public domain. And as you can see, these are all the works that just came into the public domain this year. You can see The Great Gatsby there on the slide. You can see Sweet Georgia Brown, the song. And of course, Ma Rainey. Well, Ma Rainey is much in the news today because there's a great Netflix series called Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. So this just came into the public domain, but everything after that is still in the public domain and still is commercially exploitable by people. The public domain consists of things that either can't be copyrighted, like ideas, or things that don't have copyright either because the copyright ended, it expired. But for African-Americans, during the 1909 Copyright Act, which went till 1976. Now, if you think about all the music that was created in that time, it's pretty much all the music that you listen to today is based on that. The blues, jazz, rock and roll, all of it was created during, and that's all under copyright still, be clear about that. And so a lot of those artists never received anything because they didn't comply with the formalities, the right paperwork. They didn't file the right things. And this is a travesty, I think, of American copyright law. And it's not just a problem of a past, since all of these works are still actually the ones that aren't in the public domain are still, they're still able to have compensation paid to them. I'll tell you a little story here about how one person can kind of change your life. So that is the king of funk, the great George Clinton. And a number of years ago, I had never planned on getting involved in this particular area of copyright. It's called copyright terminations. And then a representative for George Clinton came out to me and he said, look, we have this case. The case is going up to the Ninth Circuit. Can you help us? And when the king asks you to help, you don't say no, right? And so I joined this team as an expert consultant for George Clinton, and we went up to the Ninth Circuit. And the issue in the Ninth Circuit was whether a law firm that he owed over $1 million to in legal fees could take his copyrights in lieu of taking payment, something that has never been done, by the way, in American copyright jurisprudence. And in fact, there's a specific copyright provision that came about during the Cold War, because in Russia, during the old Soviet Union, in order to silence dissidents, they would simply take their copyrights away from them. So we put in our law a provision that says you cannot take a person's copyright for it, that you cannot basically expropriate their copyright. And the Ninth Circuit heard that case and completely unsympathetic to George Clinton. And for me, this is a big wake-up call, because yes, I teach this and I practice law, but just seeing how horribly. The courts are treating these artists. George Clinton is one of the greatest musicians alive. For those of you who don't know him, look him up. But I'll tell you what, there's no hip hop, which I know you all like, unless we have two people, James Brown and George Clinton, right? They're at the foundation of hip hop. That's what hip hop is built on. And yet they treated his works like a sack of potatoes and allowed it to be sold off to a law firm. And this is a very traumatic experience to me, as you might imagine, because I got to know George and I actually still work with him on some matters. And I just thought, how do we have a copyright system that treats our geniuses this way? You know, and what a scandal it is. And it's still happening today. This is 2014, by the way, that we went up to the Ninth Circuit. I just learned about this one recently. Jazz standard? If it's not, it's got to be the second, right? So in terms of jazz, Round Midnight is like the gold standard for jazz, right? There's a few others we could pick, Miles Davis, Kind of Blue, etc., but it's got to be right up there. And if you there's Thelonious Monk in the slide here, his son. Of course, Thelonious Monk died years ago, one of the greatest jazz men of all time, but I was on a panel with T.S. Monk, his son, who's also a great musician, and he told a story of how Thelonious Monk didn't end up getting the copyright to Round Midnight. And I said, how can this be? How did this man who created this song, which is at the foundation of jazz, not own it? And he also talked about, he said, you would have thought a genius. And, you know, Thelonious Monk is our Beethoven. He's like a black Beethoven or Bach. This is just astonishing to me. Now, by the way, all this, that song was made like in 1946. It would still very much be under copyright today. This is the dark side or underbelly of our copyright system, which few want to talk about, which I think in the light of our the Black Lives Matter movement and this new awakening that we can maybe finally get some traction on and make some changes about it, right? About how we're treating artists. Of course, here's a copyright registration form. It's one page front and back, but I can tell you that artists who look at that, it looks like Greek to them, or it looks like, you know, calculus to them. And just last year, a year and a half ago, the Supreme Court in the case called Fourth Estate held that unless you have a copyright registration that's fully completed, you can't sue anybody in court. Now, for those of us who work in the music space particularly, know that music artists, they simply don't register their copyrights. And the Supreme Court did that so cavalierly, so casually. Well, it's okay. They can just, you know, take the time to register. No. We're dealing with communities who aren't, you know, Ivy League, you know, rich people who can very easily navigate and negotiate these things. One page, but very, very difficult for artists to fill out on their own. This is what's happening in the world of copyright today. Of course, there's Victor Willis, and he did YMCA. And one of my projects now is trying to reform our copyright termination. Copyright termination allows artists who sign bad deals to get their rights back after a specified time. Under the current 1976 Act is 35 years. So if Victor Willis signed away his rights to YMCA and Macho Man and In the Navy, and he did, he was entitled to get those rights back 35 years, which is very significant. If you own the rights to YMCA, you would be a multimillionaire. If you understand how music public, just that one song, you could have a mansion. I'm still down here in San Diego. I haven't moved up to LA yet. Coronado is the fancy neighbor. You could have a mansion very easily in Coronado just based on that one song. What's important for these artists who got taken advantage of early in their careers to be able to recapture their copyrights, that's what our copyright law says. However, if you really look at the mechanics of it, it's almost impossible to actually effectuate a copyright termination. He actually did get his rights back. But the other part of that story, which I find even more interesting, is that people who didn't write the song wrong, were on the copyright certificate. And this is a what I copyright scandal. The copyright office is not policing who is claiming copyright in things. And this is killing people at the lower end of the economic spectrum. And I write about that in the article.
Yet our best trained, best educated, best equipped, best prepared troops refuse to fight. Matter of fact, it's safe to say that they would rather switch than fight.
That's my old client, Public Enemy. In 1989, those works from 1986, 87, 89, if these artists haven't started the process to recapture those works, because that's almost 35 years, remember I said you can get them back after 35 years, they'll never be able to recapture them. And what will happen is that the people who own those rights, which is typically a major record label or music publishing company, will keep those rights. And hip hop is pure gold in the marketplace. It's used in movies. It's used in commercials. It's used in television shows. So all that old school hip hop is worth a fortune. And we know it's worth a fortune because these Wall Street money men are buying up hip hop catalogs like hotcakes. They bought the Wu-Tang catalog. They bought another catalog from a hip hop group, buying this stuff up like crazy. So they recognize the value of it. And I call this reverse redistribution, that these artists who were taken advantage of and signed horrible deals, and I've looked at these deals in the beginning of their careers, they finally have a shot to get it back, and they're not getting it back because of the way our law is structured, right? And that's the reform that I think needs to be done. The time I have left, which isn't much, about 10 minutes, just let me tell you a little bit about my book. So I wanted to write a book that wasn't a traditional academic book about copyright. And I call my book The Copyright House of Horrors because it explores how African-American artists particularly have been exploited, expropriated by copyright law. And I do it through the lens of my son. My son, you know, at that time he was 17, a couple of years ago. He ends up taking a wrong turn when he goes to a music exhibit. He enters this netherworld, this underground world, which we call the Copyright House of Horrors. He's basically accosted by this character I call the guide. And this guide, in essence, takes him through these various things in copyright law, which have been so harmful to African-American artists. He tells him that, you know, you're in the presence of the law. It's a little Kafka-esque here, right? As you could probably tell, that the law is this overwhelming thing, right? In Kafka's work, the law is, you know, I don't want to say that it's evil, but it's, you know, it's all pervasive. And of course, he can't even walk here. You know, it's so powerful, the impact of the law, showing the power of the law in our society. Of course, a house of horrors because copyright law has been great for some, but not all. And of course, here's Jelly Roll Morton, who with some justification claims that he created jazz. He wasn't the only one, but he's right there at the foundation of jazz. And of course, it took many years, and he's not the only artist in that era. Didn't die without even a headstone on their graves, right? Talk about a blank check, right, for this amazing creator. He also appears in the book. There's this old bluesman there too in the House of Horrors, and he's there to help break, understand what happened because he lived through it, right? He's obviously, it's a kind of a fictional book, so he couldn't have possibly be alive today, but he is alive in the book, and he guides him through the House of Horrors. Things are so horrible here, at some points he has to be blindfolded, which of course is a metaphor for what Ralph Ellison in his great book, Invisible Man, he talked about how African-Americans are invisible in society, right? And so the, you know, the converse of that is, yeah, they're also blind to some things because of that. So this is one of my favorite parts of the book. He goes upstairs, he can hear music, and it's like this old, you know, 1920 style bar. And who there is having a conversation over tequila, but Prince, Michael Jackson, and Madonna. And the conversation is about cultural appropriation. And it's funny, in my copyright class, we had this huge discussion about this just a couple of days ago, because I cover a case involving Taylor Swift, her Shake It Off song. And so there was a big debate over whether that song was appropriative. And that's a big thing that people are talking about now. Now, there's a difference between copyright infringement, which is, you know, has very strict standards, and cultural appropriation, which may be hard to define. But in that conversation, it's revealed the Jackson 5's terrible contract that they signed. The Prince's $150 million Warner Brothers deal, which wasn't $150 million, right? And we explained how that happened. He thought he was getting $150. That's why he put Slave on his face, but he didn't understand how music industry contracts work. And of course, Madonna, and back to cultural appropriation. And she fires back, well, Michael, you didn't really create the moonwalk and you took that. And Prince is a combination of kind of James Brown and Little Richard and some other characters. So they go back and forth. I think it's a really fun discussion. Of course, Vogue is appropriative in their minds, because she took that from the African-American gay community. Voguing was something they did in those clubs. And she really did just take it and didn't give any credit to that community. So maybe that's a good example of cultural appropriation, right? Okay, I'm gonna move on here in the interest of time, but it's funny how they go back and forth, and they all were very competitive against each other, right? Those three, they were all born in 58. It's funny, all born at the same time, all became the major stars of the, all had problems with each other, right? Madonna, Prince, and MJ. But with the Jackson 5, it's revealed that even though the Jackson 5 had all those hits, including I Want You Back, Stop the Love You Save, ABC, when they left Motown, Motown said, you actually owe us money. You owe us from their contract with Motown. So that's all talked about in the book. Bessie Smith appears along with Mamie Smith. Bessie Smith was the empress of the blues, right? The greatest blues singer of all times. That's the great Bessie Smith. Most people don't know there was actually two African-American women who launched the American music industry in 1920. One was called Bessie Smith, but the other one was Mamie Smith, who she did her song Crazy Blues, which really was the start of the beginning of the American record industry. And of course, Bessie Smith floated the company at that time, which today would be called Sony, right? So she actually floated that company just on her record sales alone. Many people don't know that the role of African-American women in this has been much underreported. I have these creatures here called the lackeys of the man in my book. And they basically are, it's just a metaphor for the fact that copyright law and IP law generally is built on these formalities and these steps that you have to take, the paperwork. And that's why the man wins. The man knows the paperwork and the artists don't. And that's really what it comes down to. I'm not gonna get into all of this, the US Copyright Office. I'm running out of time, so I don't wanna go over, but let me just tell you about this scene in the book. I'll end with this. So he's in this house of horrors and he sees this dungeon-like place and he can hear someone singing, right? He can hear music, you know, coming out of it. And so the character, the biracial kid, you know, walks towards the sound and this is what he hears.
Good night.
that's Be My Baby, which actually that song in 64 or whatever year it was actually knocked the Beatles off the charts, which is an impossible thing to do. And the Beatles all wanted to meet this Ronnie Ronette, but she married Phil Spector, who just died. And she's in this prison, which I call the prison of performance or dungeon of performance in the book, because copyright law treats performers horribly. She did not write Be My Baby. Phil Spector and some other writers wrote it. And because she's not the writer of the song under copyright, just the singer or the performer, she has absolutely no rights to the song. And this was brought home a few years ago when she did a Broadway play about her life, and she wanted to sing Be My Baby. And she asked Phil Spector, because she needs to get rights from Phil Spector because she doesn't own the song. And Phil Spector would not give her the rights to use the song in her own play or retrospective about her. This is another area which is ripe for reform in the United States. Why do we treat performers so horribly? And why do we only honor composers, people who write the song? This is a big thing that we have to get with. Okay, I'm running just about right on time or out of time. I did have a poem I would share with you, but I don't want to go over time. So I could do that another time. I'll just defer to Lisa and the rest if you want me to.
Go right ahead, Professor Green. I think you have everyone's attention right now. They're so engaged with your topic. So I'm sure they would love to hear the poem. Go right ahead.
Okay. So this poem I did because I was told I had 5 minutes to do a presentation at Duke last month, I sponsored a conference about the public domain. And it was great because they had a celebration. It was a lot of people too. And they were wearing hats like from the 1920s, those funny hats with the band around it. And they were having such a good time. But African-Americans, I think, view the public domain very different. The public domain, they were celebrating. It's like, wow, all the stuff, we can use it for free. Hemingway, right? And all those works that you saw. But for African-Americans, the public domain has been this double-edged sword. And since they said, you only have 5 minutes or less to present, I said, I don't know what I'm gonna say. So that night before, my wife's right here, she can verify, I wrote this poem that night before the conference. And it's called An Ode to the Public Domain. So I'll end with this. The public domain is a mythical place where, like an etch-a-sketch, copyright restrictions get magically erased. Marvelous, remarkable, a wonderful thing. But lurking beneath are questions of race. The public domain is so messily constructed that blues and jazz artists too often found their works obscenely obstructed. To begin with, copyright certainly does not smile on things Black folk create through improvisation and style. For Black creators, the disparities of what's in and what's out seem persistently persistent wholly throughout. You see, 17 USC, that's the Copyright Act, by the way, that's where it's found. Not everyone's equal when it comes to resources. Some are like riders deprived of their horses. Blues artists, for example, often could neither read nor write. This left them vulnerable to all kinds of spite, left without a coat, so to speak, out in the cold rain, wet and very vulnerable to the public domain. And if you don't believe me and want me to shut up, go and take a look at what happened to author Big Boy Crudup. The public domain rules are so convoluted and full of shape-shifting surprises that even grizzled IP lawyers oft meet deadly demises, slashed by blades of complexity, trying to figure it all out. 10 hours on Lexis and still full of doubt. Grasping for clarity, a slippery trout. Is this work still protected? Is it in? Is it out? If solving public domain rules can make pinstripe lawyers at Fox Films swelter, what hope could there be for the old blues men fresh from the Mississippi Delta? Oh, the places you'll go, once declared Dr. Seuss, a book incidentally not subject to fair use, but for the ghost of the blues, it seems far more germane to speak of works lost to the public domain. For Black artists, oh, the copyrights you'll lose seems much more than copyright law's treatment a Black artist in this room is the elephant. But why, some here secretly ask, does Professor Green crash our swell party with dark copyright tales of the past? Like the greenest Grinch who stole Christmas, he's at it again. Although this green's not really greenish, but a medium brown tint. Pray tell, who let him come here? Who let him in? Here's the truth. For Black creators, the situation's always been dire. And the great public domain has been as friendly as a work made for hire. And works made for hire aren't friendly, not even a little. Unless, of course, you're a big corporate entity wielding contracts like swords with Ivy League lawyers and menacing hordes. Meanwhile, the true innovator, the real creator, she wields a dull butter knife. Call it what you will, but don't call it a fair fight. Here's a question for all here to entertain. Why did the works of Black authors so often end up swallowed by the And I'll clue you in about Black music and what I call copyright's seven deadly sins, and mesmerize minds with my book that's a holler, a tale of a biracial youth trapped in a netherworld known. This sounds crazy, but please hear me out now. There's really no need for an IP ruckus. Just let me ask you this. How many folks here know that Dr. King's dream speech barely escaped death in the public domain's clutches? More importantly, how many poor artists lost all in the haze of formalities? Let's face it, the whole bleeping structure has caused a monstrous calamity and deprived Black creators of hard-earned creative equity. So you published a song without a copyright notice? Sorry, madam, your copyright's gone. Oh, did you miss your renewal deadline? Bro, get out of town. You wanna try something that'll explode your mind? Try figuring out the copyright term for a work created from March 1978 to March 1st, 1989. Excuse me for saying so, but yo, please let a brother vent. This copyright system seems designed with just one overriding intent: to preserve at all costs the interests of the great 1%. Well, my poem's almost finished. I hope you enjoyed. I roasted rather than toasted the public domain here, but please don't be too annoyed. My job as a professor, after all, is to challenge copyright norms. Speak with me later. I'll tell you all about my ideas for reforms. In the meantime, let there be no ill will between us as we seek a path forward for copyright justice. And if you take no more than this from my poetic chatter, I hope you'll recall this: Black artist lives matter. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Green. I know you can't see the chat because you were so engaged, but people are loving this topic. I think you're going to have 75 sections of copyright that you're going to have to take just to accommodate all of these students that are so keenly interested in your scholarship. We do have a break in the schedule right now. So we have about 10 minutes that we're going to allow for this break. So your choices are either step away, grab a glass of orange juice, or you can stay and ask Professor Green some questions. Hopefully he'll indulge some for the next 10 minutes. So if you need to step away, please feel free, just be back in 10 minutes. If not, Professor Green, if you don't mind, we'll take some questions from the audience.
Yes, I'd love it.
Okay, so if you have, if you wanna raise your Zoom hand, or if your camera is on and you raise your physical hand, I will call on you. So anybody would like to go first? Edwin, go right ahead and unmute yourself.
Good morning, everybody. Oh, wow. Professor Green, I am like the biggest George Clinton fan. Just seeing that, I have my Funkadelic sweater. I got to show it. I wore this last night.
Wow. You know what? The other thing, Edwin, is so many times you meet, you know, famous people, celebrities, and they're jerks. I mean, he is just literally the nicest guy you'll ever meet, you know?
So, he seems like the coolest. I don't really have a question. I just kind of wanted to make a point that was amazing, but
My funk the P-funk.
Yeah, for sure. All right, let's
there. Thank you, Edwin.
Thank you.
Hey, anyone else? Samantha.
Good morning, Professor Green. That was an awesome presentation.
Thank you, Samantha.
You're welcome. I was just wondering, given your passion and the, how big of an issue this is, has there ever been a task force of students that could go out and approach the artists? And why did you lose the case in the Ninth District?
Those are good questions. Okay, so in the Ninth Circuit, we lost that case because I was you know, I was acting as a consultant. I wasn't a testifying expert. I was trying to help the team in that case on procedural grounds. So it tells you the civil procedure, by the way, is very, 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 very important. It was a motion to reconsider. The Ninth Circuit said it should have been a different motion and therefore it wasn't timely. That was basically the bottom line. Now, that was absolutely bogus because all of, and particularly my colleagues here who were litigated, have litigated, you all know if a court wants a way around one of those procedural hurdles, they can do it. There's so many different ways they can do it as well, but they just didn't want to do it. You know, what was really alarming to me is I don't think the Ninth Circuit knew who George Clinton was, right? And this is a problem that our judiciary is completely unrepresentative. It's in gender and in race. I mean, the racial disparities of our judiciary are particularly, they're really, really alarming. And so the only, in all this litigation that we went through with him, it seemed the only judge that gave him a shot was a Black judge in Los Angeles, right? Was the only one. And all the rest of the judges, they were wholly unsympathetic to him. And so the substantive arguments we made is they shouldn't be able to take away his copyrights. They didn't hear that because they said, well, there's this procedural issue. And so we're not even going to deal with those issues. That was it. In terms of the task force, I think that's a great idea. The truth of the matter is, there's a lot of movement afoot in this area now to try to make these changes. I showed you that other slide with myself with T.S. Monk and the woman Binta Brown. You can look her up. She's got some really serious initiatives. She was a Wall Street lawyer, so she knows the system inside out. There are other people, Professor MT University and their Center for Copyright Justice is doing initiatives here for us. So there's a lot of work. It's just not coordinated, right? So a lot of people are doing a lot of things. Let me just say this to conclude your question. The labels and music publishers, they're not serious about this either. They are not serious. What they just did was Universal Music just said they're going to give $25 million to the African-American community for initiatives in the community. And people like me are like, Drake makes that in an hour on Spotify, okay? This is serious. Really, $25? And to me, it's not just about a giveaway as well. It's about fundamentally changing the system that we're in. And so I probably will get in trouble for saying some of the things I say, but that's why Dean Prager gave me tenure, so I can say them, presumably, right? But yeah, I mean, $25 million, Universal? No.
If this is your definition of trouble, I think we're doing all right.
I just want to be clear that the faculty gave you tenure, not me.
That's correct.
Thank you, Professor.
Very interesting. Okay, I think next up is going to be... Tanara, did you have your hand up? Okay, go right ahead.
Thank you so much, and thank you for that presentation, Professor Green. It's interesting that you are talking about, you know, really trying to change the legislator and everything as it relates to artists being able to truly have their rights recognized. What resonated with me most in your PowerPoint was about Be My Baby, the Ronettes. I had not known that she hadn't had a copyright at all. And it's interesting. Do you believe that the same instance and I guess law could be used when models are trying to copyright or get more recognition for their face? Because I know they can't necessarily... in fashion law, which is something I've been interested in a while, is that models can't necessarily copyright themselves. And it seems like the same could be said about singers who have composers. Am I making the right correlations? Does that seem correct?
I mean, in a sense, yes. I mean, that's not how the law works, although that's how some people, it's another avenue that people could use. So you're right, you can't copyright your face. You can copyright a picture of your face, right? Or your face in a movie, the movie itself or the picture is. And so we have a different area of law called rights of publicity that protects people's likeness, their image, their face, their photo. And so a lot of times in the music industry particularly, that's where all the money is being made now. So look at Jay-Z, for example. Jay-Z does not make his money from record sales. Yeah, he makes some money from record sales, but they say he's close to a billionaire now. None of that is from music. It's all from his investments, his trademarks, his using his image, right? That's how they're monetizing it right now. But, and so models have that protection. fashion law, by the way, is not for the most part protected under copyright law. They've been trying to get an amendment to the Copyright Act to protect it forever, but there's been slow going on that. But you are right to say that there are other avenues. In terms of performers, I think that's a tough one to kind of put it in that category. And this is something you'll learn about in law school, but there's something called preemption. So copyright is a federal law. And so any state law which is too close to copyright is going to be preempted. In other words, they'll prevent that law from coming together. And we see that problem. I can give you an example. It was J-Lo. So there was a song that this woman did called, what was the name of the song? It was all, well, the J-Lo song is All I Have. And it's based on a 1970 song. And the woman who sang the song in the 1970 said, wait a minute, J-Lo's using my song. She's not paying anything. Well, she didn't have a copyright in the song. So she has no, she said, well, great. Let me use that right of publicity, basically, segment. And the federal court says, sorry, it's preempted. It's copyright or nothing. So there are some problems with it, but I think you are on track in terms of how you're thinking about it. Yes.
Thank you. Kiara, did you still have your question?
Yes, I actually don't have a question. I just want to say I'm in awe. This has been amazing. I took a class with John Kellogg. I don't know if you know him, but
yes, I do.
Yes, he's amazing. And this just blew me away. So I just want to say thank you.
Thank you, Kiara. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Thank you. I think everybody's in agreement. Amy, you had your hand up. Did you still have a question?
Wasn't most of a question. I also just wanted to say that, you know, I always knew I wanted to go into entertainment law, and I just didn't know how, like, I could go into entertainment law, but also, you know, help the, you know, persons of color and Black people, and just, like, you kind of just, like certified everything that I want to do, and I just want to say thank you. I think it's awesome, and I just can't wait to, like, take a class with you, and just thank you so much. Everything that you said, I was like, I couldn't help but sing with for every song that you said. I was like singing along to everything because that's the music I grew up on, so I just think it was great. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Amy. Thank you so much. Wow.
Great, thank you. And I think we have time for one more question. Anybody had one? I know Patience had her hand up earlier. Did you still?
Oh. Yes, thank you for that. So thank you, Professor Green, for your insight and creating justice on a different front that we don't typically think of. So thank you for being a warrior in that right. So my question was, maybe we have potential clients in the future, how would you start them off in thinking about, you know, protecting their interests going forward? Because of course they're balancing that thought of, I want to be in the industry, but of course they don't want to be broke at the end of it. You know, they want to have their creations protected.
And I know some of my colleagues, I know Orly here or works in the space as well. It's very difficult. It's quite, particularly starting out. I mean, you're gonna be handed a deal. Most of it is not gonna be negotiable. You know, and you could have a lawyer that tries to do what as much as she can. You know, the industry's position is that, look, yeah, this is a terrible deal, whether it's a movie deal, whether it's a record deal. However, if you do well, you will be rewarded. You know, you'll get rewarded later. My whole thing with that is, well, what if you only have one work, right? What if you only have one good song? Well, too late, because you're not going to get paid on that one. What's the name of that? You Are My Lady? You know that song, Freddie Jackson?
Oh, yeah. You Are My Lady.
I know the guy who wrote that. However, he is not on the copyright certificate. He wrote it and they just straight up took it, right? And that would, by the way, owning the rights to that song would be very valuable. Played at weddings. It's a beautiful song, right? You Are My Lady. So this is the industry that we live in. And by the way, it keeps a lot of people out too. I see that. We're supposed to incentivize people with copyright law, right? Bring them in. I know so many artists that are exactly what you're talking about. They are terrified to do anything because they know all these horror stories of what's going to happen to their works. But all we can do is hopefully they have representation in the beginning, but most of the time they don't. You know, lawyers are very... very expensive. The other thing I see, a remedy, and I've seen many, many times people call me, for some reason they find me. I'm not practicing law, but I listen to everybody because I feel like I have a pro bono obligation that if somebody calls my office, I'm going to listen to their story and I'm going to refer them to somebody that can help them, right? And this happens pretty much every week, right? It's at least one call a week I get on this. So I hear all of this stuff. And these artists are terrified because they know that, you know, they can be taken advantage of and they don't know how to protect themselves. You know, so we need to do a better job at getting people representation for sure. Maybe some of you, maybe you'll be that person.
There we go. Thank you, Professor Green.
Or maybe it'll be Terry, right?
Right, for that elbow nudge. Yes.
The thing is though, Terry, you still have to pay the bills, right? And you're not gonna make a lot of money off of these clients. That's the catch 22.
All right. Well, thank you so much again, Professor Green. If we can get—
Thank you. Thanks for inviting me. Yeah.
And just for that amazing, amazing presentation. I know I learned so much. I think we've seen in the chat from the comments that our guests here really enjoyed your presentation. And so thank you for shedding light on this very important issue, especially as we're approaching Black History Month, to just be more empowered and to inspire the next attorneys to maybe go into this area of practice. So we just really want to thank you for this presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Dean.
Yeah, so I just want to take a quick moment to make an announcement to some of the students that might be interested in pursuing a career in civil rights work, right? We know that it's a much needed area, and we know the cost of law school is very expensive, and just trying to balance if you're, you know, making that decision that you want to go into work, but how will you make a living once you come out of law school. So I want to introduce a really special opportunity that's being brought by the NAACP. Their Legal Defense Fund has created the Marshall Motley Scholarship Fund, which is named after Thurgood Marshall and civil rights litigator Constance Motley. And it's a scholarship opportunity for law school applicants who have demonstrated a commitment to fighting for racial equity and justice. And over the next 5 years, this fund is fully funded to annually put 10 students through law school. And so it's an amazing opportunity. It will cover all tuition, all living expenses, and it will also put students into a 2-year intensive civil rights training program. And those that are selected will commit to do 8 years working in the South on civil rights issues. So it's a new opportunity, unlike any other that I've at least heard of in quite some time. And so for those that are interested, a really nice thing about this scholarship is that for candidates, they're not looking at undergraduate GPA or LSAT scores if you have been admitted to law school. If you've not yet been admitted to a law school, they are considering LSAT scores and undergraduate GPAs just for the purpose of determining if you will be admitted to a law school in that application cycle. So I just wanted to plug this great opportunity for anyone who's interested in civil rights work. I will be sure to drop the website in the chat so that students can check that out. And the application deadline is February 16th. And again, that is the NAACP's Legal Defense Fund Marshall Motley Scholarship. So I hope interested students will check that out.
Well, thank you, Dean Duenas, and welcome to everyone. My name is Robert Mena. I'm the Associate Dean for Student Affairs, and I think many of us would argue about who has the best job on campus, but I know that I do. I have the opportunity of working closely with our students on a daily basis, and nothing excites me more. Now, I have to tell you this. When Dean Duenas and I, with the assistance of our admissions team, created this program, we knew we had a problem, right? And the problem was that we needed something to follow Professor Green, right? Something that we thought was going to be motivating enough to all of you to follow what you just saw, which was incredible, right? And when we thought about what would follow, it was clear to us, right? Because as I listened to Dean Prager give her opening remarks, right? She mentioned what makes this place special. And it's our students. It's our students. And so we knew that after Professor Green, we needed to follow with our students. And I can't tell you how excited I am to hear them today. What I wanted to do first was I wanted to, for each of them to introduce themselves, and I'll call on them right now to introduce themselves, because what we're going to be talking today is about leadership, leadership in law school. And I know many of you are thinking right now, many of you prospective law students are thinking, I'm good with that. I hear what I have to do is do well academically, and I'm going to come to school every day. I'm going to take my classes and I'm going to leave. If you do that, you will miss the opportunity of being a leader. And so today, you're going to get the opportunity to hear what happens when you do get involved, when you do take that leadership opportunity, and you're going to hear from the best of the best, which is our students. I'm going to call on this first student right now. Abron, if you can go ahead and tell us your name, tell us your program of study, and tell us the activities that you take part in outside of the classroom.
Sure. Hi, everyone. Welcome. My name's Abraham Bran. I am a 3L in the traditional day program. I am I'm concentrating at Southwestern in civil litigation and advocacy and public interest law. I am president of the Southwestern Student Bar Association, which is basically student government, our student body government. I am also co-president to our Latino Law Students Association and our Environmental Law Society. I am part of our law review, and I am a teaching assistant and research assistant for multiple professors on campus. I absolutely love being obviously involved in the Southwestern community, partially because, it's really great to have a variety of experiences to allow you to really develop and grow as an attorney, but also because I love working with the different faculty and professors and staff that we have, and I'm really proud of being part of this community. So I think I'll just kind of cut it there, but I can keep going and going. I just want to give time to everyone else.
Thank you so much, Abe. I'm going to point to Angel. If you don't mind introducing yourself, program of study, and activities that you're a part of. Angel, we can't seem to hear you, Angel.
We can come back to Angel, maybe. We'll let her
audio. Yeah, let's go ahead and go to Eliana. If you can go ahead and name program of study and activities you're a part of.
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Eliana Amirian. I'm a 3L in the traditional day program as well, and I'm working towards a concentration in criminal law and advocacy. I'm super involved here on campus. I'm the director of academic affairs for the Student Bar Association that Abe just mentioned earlier. I'm also the president of the Armenian Law Students Association. I'm also a Dean's Fellow and a lead articles editor for Southwestern's Journal of International Law.
Thank you so much, Eliana. Nolan, if you can go ahead and introduce yourself, program of study and activities you're a part of.
Hi, everybody. My name is Nolan Ardekia. I am president of our Outlaw group. It's our LGBT and allies student organization. I'm also a Dean's Fellow. I am a student editor for our Journal of International Media of Entertainment Law, as well as a member of our negotiation honors program and our entertainment clinic. I am studying civil litigation as well as entertainment law, and I'm happy to be here.
Thank you so much, Nolan. Let's go back to Angel. Angel, if you can introduce yourself, program of study and also activities you're a part of.
Okay, can you guys hear me okay now?
Yes, perfect, Angel, thank you.
These are one of the wonderful things of attending law school via Zoom. But hello, everyone. My name is Angel Ajala. I am a 2L in the traditional day program. I have my grubby little fingers in a lot of programs on campus outside of the classroom. I am in the Student Bar Association. I am the Director of Community Outreach and Building. I'm also now newly elected onto the Peer Mentor Advisory Board, but I've been a peer mentor all year, so I'm excited about that. I'm also the event coordinator for the Black Law Students Association. So come on down, we got a home for you. We're ready to give you a big virtual hug. And I am also the co-founder of SBA's Safe Space Series, which is an event series that we have every month here at Southwestern, where we highlight invite our affinity organizations and allow them to talk about their struggles, talk about the social and legal justice issues that are currently impacting their community. The goal of this is to do the goal that all of Southwestern is here for, right? To provide that safe space of alliance and building true allyship that isn't performative. We want to create that safe space, and we do so every month here at Southwestern. And I appreciate you guys so much for inviting me to be a part of the panel. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Angel. Maida.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. My name is Maida Maturana. I am a three-day traditional day student. Currently trying to be in the civil litigation concentration as well. I'm involved with the Latino Law Student Association with Abe, which Abe is the president of. I don't think he mentioned that. I also got involved with the Safe Space series that Angel does, and I was able to do that for the Latino Law Student Association. During my second year, I got involved heavily with the legal clinics on both semesters. And currently that was my baby, and that's Myra.
Thank you so much, Myra. You've met our students. We're going to transition into having an understanding as to what this leadership means, because I think many of you who are prospective students will think, you know, when you think of leadership at a law school, you probably think of the faculty, the administration. But for many of us, we really think of our students. And so, Dean Duenas, if you want to start us off, please.
Absolutely. And thank you to Abe, Angel, Nolan, Eliana, Myra for joining us on this Saturday morning. So I kind of want to start the discussion with hearing maybe from Angel in particular on how did the national and global events that we experienced this year as a community influence your work and what you were able to lead our student organizations in providing our student body this year at Southwestern.
Thank you, Dean Duenas. I definitely think I, along with the rest of the world, where it's just at home, we're isolated, we're confined to our communities, our families, our dogs, our cats, and then we're already confined in this pandemic, but then we experience this sort of like country shattering event, right? The death of George Floyd. And that sprung a series of events that raised a lot of legal questions, because when you're in law school, all you think about is the law. And so I'm thinking, what are the rights that the protesters have? What is happening? How is this allowable? What are the ramifications that can be brought against this officer? Why don't we have a space in our law school to talk about these things? Because when you're in law school, you're here to learn the law. And it's very difficult to teach the law and give out all of the rules while also having those theoretical conversations about what this means today. And so we were just missing a space. It really inspired me to sort of reach out to Abe, who is our student body president and is literally, in my opinion, the glue that holds the world together. But I reached out to him and I said, you know, I think we need to have a discussion, like a group community discussion at Southwestern about these issues and about how they've impacted our communities, my community in particular, because I'm Nigerian American, but obviously I identify as a Black woman raised in America. And, you know, Abe was like, this is a great idea. We need to do it. We teamed up with BOLSA, and just the mere attendance at that town hall over the summer was astonishing. I think we had over 250 participants on a Zoom event in the middle of the summer. No one has any obligation to be here, except we all share this common thread of wanting to speak about these issues and wanting to address them. And I feel like the takeaway from that conversation and a lot of the insight that we took from the students, from their experiences, from the professors, from the faculty, and from the administration really showed that this was sort of a void that needed to be filled. We needed a space to speak about how things that are happening every day to our communities are impacting us. And that sort of inspired the Safe Space series. I teamed up with Abe and we bred it. And now every single month we highlight our affinity organizations on on or around the second Tuesday of every month. This month we're going to, or in February, we're going to be highlighting our Women's Law Association, and they're going to talk about a lot of the present issues that are impacting women and the intersectionality that exists as it applies to all of our communities, the Latino community, the Asian Pacific Islander community, the Black community. And I think that that is the fabric of Southwestern and what makes us so great. Sorry, I talk a lot. Everyone knows that already, but you guys don't. You'll see it though.
Thank you, Angel. Thank you for that. And I think it was just, at least as someone working at Southwestern, it was amazing to see how particularly the Black Law Student Association took that experience that we all had this past summer and with your help, the help of Abe, created an opportunity to empower other student organizations on campus to share their stories, to share their experiences so that we could come together more as a community. And I wanna kind of now follow up with a question to the group. And Eliana, you come in mind, come to my mind particularly, and how you know, the use of town halls and other opportunities to raise issues faced by our community members, how the Armenian Law Student Association used that as an opportunity as well this year to shed light on issues impacting our community members.
Thank you for thinking of me. Yeah, as Angel said, the Black Law Students Association was really the association that opened that door for so many other affinity groups to have the room to speak about issues that affect all of us. And particularly this last semester, I won't go too into detail, but there was a war that began in Armenia, in the historic areas of Armenia in Artsakh. And it was a 45-day war where many of our own students, family members were being called to war overnight. We were all being asked to help with the war efforts here as diasporans. And it was really, really a struggle for all of us mentally, emotionally, as law students, dealing with a pandemic, dealing with distance learning, and now that on top of it. So we were able to utilize that idea that the Black Law Students Association used in the summer. And we also held our own town hall meeting where we were able to educate so many of our classmates, our professors, faculty, deans. They were all in attendance and so supportive. The Armenian community, I don't think has ever felt more supported here at Southwestern than we did this last semester. And it's, we really, really do appreciate everybody here. And it made us feel so welcome and loved. So we got support all around. We had professors that were compassionate and understanding about our situation. If we seemed disengaged in class, we had faculty members and deans donating to help us. So I think it really shows what that Southwestern means, what they say when they care about their students and they care about the communities that belong here. So.
Thank you, Eliana. Such important issues, and we appreciate your leadership this year. Abe, I wanna, and also Nolan, I'm gonna ask you both. Abe, I'm gonna start with you, and then Nolan, I want you to answer this as well. I want you to think back before you started law school, and I want you to take a different path where you weren't involved on campus and all you did was come to class, right? Go home. And I just want you to think about, what do you think you would have missed in terms of your leadership ability and your educational experience?
Well, I think that's a bit of a tough question because I don't see a circumstance where I wouldn't have pursued some kind of leadership opportunity. And I think this might go a little bit into kind of my background. I definitely don't see myself necessarily as like a leader per se. I don't feel like I am someone that goes around and like ordering people and traditionally like managing groups and things like that. I feel like my leadership style is more of a like empowerment circumstance where I've had the pleasure to work with everyone on this panel, and each of them will approach me with any kind of idea or kind of theory like Angel was saying. And what we do together is really work on developing this. And so I think that if I weren't to have pursued a leadership style role, I still would see myself working with people, working with individuals that maybe have these ideas on like, in terms of putting them, like putting pen to paper, if you will, really get the ball rolling, really make these things thoughtful and creative. And Angel was as she was talking about the Safe Space series, it's weird because we think about Zoom and Zoom fatigue, and we think about how stressful it is to be on Zoom for so many hours, but we've gotten very creative with the way that we host these platforms, with the way that we have these discussions. And I don't really feel like that's an issue when it comes to the Safe Space series. And it has to do with just the way that we've created these alternative spaces, which I attribute a lot to Angel. And I also attribute to the kind of work we were able to bounce off of each other. I don't know if that directly answers your question, but that's just what I wanted to talk about.
No, it definitely does, Abe. And I wanna also ask Nolan, in terms of your involvement on campus and how that's really impacted you and what you've been doing here as a Southwestern student.
Yeah, thank you. I didn't go into law school expecting to, be the president of any student organization. I think that it came about because of my passion, which drove me to law school, which was to give back to my communities that I'm a part of, as well as communities that I'm not immediately a part of, that I'm an ally of. And the availability of a leadership position on at law came about, as well as, being a Dean's Fellow and so on and so forth. But I think, had I not taken advantage of, our student groups, Dean's Fellow, peer mentor, or anything like that, there's so many things that come along with it, right? You have the ability to network. You have the ability to advocate for really important topics like safe spaces that Angel, gave Outlaw the ability to discuss really important topics to the LGBTQ community, and the ability to connect our student groups in order to be allies to each other, and to really foster those leadership skills that potential employers are looking for in students, and which will ultimately make you a better person of your community as well as in the workplace. So I think had I not joined the leadership position or ran for a leadership position, I think that I would have missed out on a lot of opportunities, and I would not have made such good relationships with people like Abe and Angel and, all, the whole panel and, our faculty and professors and everybody. And so I think that taking advantage of those and really putting yourself out there and advocating for what you feel passionate about really empower you to be a more well-rounded student and attorney one day.
Thank you, Nolan.
Thank you for that, Nolan. And I kind of want to pick up on one of the topics that you touched upon, which is allyship, right? And I think that's such an important aspect. I think that all of us, particularly as law students, we do have some privilege in being law students to be allies for others, right? I want to turn a question over to Myra. If you could maybe describe a little bit the work that LASA did in their Safe Space series and what you feel that that work was able to do for our dreamers, right? And our students that may be non-citizens, and how the SBA Safe Series hosted by LASA maybe shed some light on how we can be better allies for that group.
Of course, thank you, Dean Dominguez. So I did the Safe Space series for LASA, that's the Latino Student Association. And I loved it when Abe was like, here, this is your baby, do it. Figure out what topic you want to talk about. And it took me some thinking as to what to discuss. But again, with everything that was going on, it's a presidential election. Immigration to me came to the forefront. It was a hot topic. It's something that it's been in my face. It's been in our faces. It's something that the previous president always kept talking about. And to go a little into my background, my parents are undocumented, and to me that was a fear of mine. You know, that also empowered me to go to law school. And I wanted to open that up and have a discussion and have people be able to have a space where they could communicate and have these a space where they could talk about it or learn about it. Or if, and part of being an allyship is teaching someone, maybe you don't come from that background, maybe this is not something that you know about, but coming together and allowing the students to learn about these experiences. And so I was able to work with Professor Beth Caldwell, who's also on this call, and I had her class as a second year. It was criminal immigration. And that's how the idea stemmed. And we work really closely in being able to discuss those issues and who are we going to bring. And it was actually her that said, there's this lady that we should bring. Her name is Lizbeth. She has a documentary. Let's talk to her. And we reached out and we brought her in. She is one of the first lawyers to be able to practice in California. And she's a DACA recipient. And she discussed about her struggles, what happened. And it really shed light, because I think all of her stories are unique. Not everybody, like her own story was different, but it resonated with me because she's first generation. She had no idea what to do. On top of that, she has to deal with immigration. On top of that, having to deal with passing the bar and doing all these things and being a DACA recipient. And then with DACA in itself, is there going to be DACA? Is there not going to be DACA? Fighting for those rights. And so it just brings a lot of emotion. It brings a lot of, like, how do we talk about these issues and opening it up? And I know I went during our Safe Space series, we had students ask, well, can we reach out to these students that are at Southwestern that are DACA recipients? And of course we cannot. We cannot divulge that information because it's private. But part of having the Safe Space series is having the opportunity to discuss about these issues and letting them know we are here. We're here together, because it's difficult to go through law school and not having a support group, but seeing how genuinely everybody cared, and not only the Latino community, you know, we have the Black Student Association, we have the Armenian Student Association, we have everybody coming together to truly try to understand these issues. And I think that's the beautiful part of being allies together. So thank you.
Thank you, Maida. So very important. I wanted to follow up.
Sorry, can I just chime in really quickly about one more little thing? So after the events of last summer, the Supreme Court also ruled on a DACA decision, basically saying that the Trump administration had terminated the program in a format that was arbitrary and capricious, and then reinstated the program in the original way as imagined by the Obama administration. And so once that happened, our Latino Law Student Association board also decided to use our networks, and we actually started this DACA specific fundraiser. So now our LASA board funds and pays for all of the DACA renewal fees for any DACA recipient here at Southwestern. So if regardless of if you identify as Latino or not. So that's just another little perk of our community. And one of our professors, Professor Julia Vasquez, who runs the Community Lawyering Clinic, also made herself available to assist in any of the legal paperwork in renewing your DACA application. So that's just another way that our student leaders get involved, get active, and make sure that we take care of our own.
Thank you so much, Abe. So I think what some of the prospective students here are maybe thinking is, how do you juggle all of this, right? I mean, you're primarily here to be a law student and, you know, graduate, pass the bar, become a great attorney, but you're spending an incredible amount of time advocating for our community and, you know, building all of these leadership skills. How do you juggle all of this, and how would you recommend, and what would you tell the prospective students today as to how to do that? I'm going to open it up. So any one of you, if you can just unmute and let us know.
I could hop in with this one. So I do a lot on campus. First and foremost, you are a student, as Dean Mena said. When you are a 1L, and this is not because we don't want you to get involved, but you actually are prohibited from holding leadership or board positions in any student organization. And that's very intentional because we want you to succeed in your 1L year. Not everyone needs to be in, you know, the top 10 and go to that big firm and going into big law, but you still nonetheless have many more opportunities when you do well and you succeed in that 1L year. So we want to make sure that you have the fundamentals of the law first. Once you pass that 1L year, you are able to kind of create your own schedule. You have more flexibility with your classes. You can incorporate less traditional casebook style classes and more skill-based courses, things like negotiating courses, trial advocacy, appellate litigation. So you can start to craft your Southwestern academic calendar as it to something more tailored to what you want to do. And for me, that meant involving myself also in some of these leadership opportunities, working with the Student Bar Association, the Latino Law Student Association, taking on these roles as a Dean's Fellow and a teaching assistant, things like that. What I will say is that I do a lot. Partially, I recognize I am not a parent, I am not married. So like, I do not have a lot of other external commitments, and I'm able to really dive myself into this work. But for individuals that do, you are able to really take on whatever you want to do. There are many leadership roles that aren't, you know, super, super involved, but you're able to serve more as a representative role, a liaison role. And I do recommend that you get involved and you try different things. Your 2L year is definitely a great time to try things out, and if it works, then stick to it and keep that going through the rest of your law school career. I think that covers my piece.
Thank you, Abe. Maybe for one more of the students, if you can kind of tell us about how you juggle all of this, including all of your academics as well.
I don't mind jumping in to follow up with Abe. I definitely will say that it's a lot, right? So it is definitely very smart that Southwestern to an extent prohibits your participation in your first year. Because if you're a person that wants to do everything right off the bat, you will overwhelm yourself. Because even if your father, mother, brother, sister, dad, anyone is a lawyer, no one can fully prepare you for the amount of work that is propounded on you and that's expected of you in your first year. But now that I'm in my second year, I feel like I've definitely started to get a little bit more better at juggling my schedule. I'm not the typical personality that comes to law school. I'm a lot more free-spirited and I just like want to run around and be like a leaf in the wind. But you know, I now have to color code things. I have to write things on my calendar. I have to really be precise about my time and really allocate periods of time and be really accountable for following up with those things. I have to check my email 272 times a day, approximately. I have to make sure that I'm answering text messages, which everyone knows that I hate to do, but it just requires a lot of activity on your part, intentional habit inserting, right? You have to make a habit of reading and setting aside time to read, setting aside time to outline, setting aside time to let your creative juices flow so that you can do something like create like the Safe Space series or something similar for your own interests. And then allowing yourself to really follow up with that time, keep coordinated and build your network so that you have people that you can trust. It's sort of a web of a job, but I do think that a lot of it comes down to your personality and coming down to prioritizing your passion and your purpose in law school. One thing I always say to myself is, remember, this is your meant to be. And whenever I say that to myself, it really centers me like, hey girl, you're supposed to be here. You're not just here for you. You're here for your community. You're here for your family. Only 2% of the attorneys in this country today are Black women. So I'm here for all of the other Black women that want to follow up after me, right? And that means
pushing myself out of my comfort zone, being a little busier than I'm used to, holding myself more accountable by inserting myself in more activities, and really learning how to get through law school without having a lot of a framework to go against. I think the juggling of those skills is what has really encouraged me and kept me involved and has brought me to being here on this panel talking to you about all the things I'm involved in. So thank you.
Thank you, Angel. And we are also now joined by Jamie Nguyen, who is a board member on our APULSA student group. So I just want to pose a question to Jamie, if you're able to share kind of how you're able to balance the responsibilities that you have on the APULSA board with being a student in the 2-year accelerated program.
Yes, and thank you for that question. And again, everyone, I'm so sorry for dropping the ball on my part. I really wanted to be here and I should double check my calendar. But so being in scale is a lot different. You're in school 5 days a week from the morning. It's like a job. And so in my first year, I never felt that I could do any extracurriculars at all. And APULSA is something I joined in my first year just because I realized I needed a community outside of scale, because scale was just so competitive. I love my classmates, but you know, you are on a curve and it's sometimes difficult to make friends with people who you're competing against. So I'm so thankful to find groups like APULSA to kind of just build a community, because for me, like, I never was somebody who would see myself as a public speaker. I know I'm in law and that sounds counterintuitive, but that's something that I really needed to cultivate in law school. And so finding APULSA was like finding a community where I could be authentic, you know, and where you are able to be yourself, I think is where you're able to kind of grow those skills that are so important, like public speaking. And in my second year now, I have a lot more free time to kind of explore different parts of my professional skills that I want to grow. And APULSA gave me this opportunity to lead the Safe Space series. And that was the first time where I was kind of pushed into being on the forefront of anything, you know? And I was terrified. I had no idea how to speak to people, how to like communicate ideas that are concepts or feelings in me and in a way that would make sense to people, you know? And so I did so much research and it was such like a great experience to just kind of like evolve as a person. You know, I felt myself grow from this kind of like meek and small person who was so shy and like hated being called on in class. Like, you know, I didn't like speaking, but being able to like put all those things together in that presentation for everyone in the Safe Space and the feedback that I got and the emails, like the connections that I made, the community that I was able to build just from being vulnerable and sharing these things, like it was amazing. It's still amazing. Like I'm here today because of that, you know? Like I wouldn't be here talking to you guys if that didn't happen. And so it's very new to me, you know, and I'm still growing, but I'm really thankful that like even in a program like Scale where it's like you're in and you're out, there's still opportunities for me to grow myself professionally, you know, that's not possible in the classroom because I'm so shy. So
thank you Jamie. And I think many of the students who are current students here have said it. I was at that Safe Space series and Jamie was absolutely inspirational. It was amazing. And I think our entire community would say that. So thank you, Jamie. Thank you for all the students. I wanted to give at least an opportunity for our prospective students to ask a few questions. I'm told by Dean Gear that we probably have to have time for about 2 questions because we're trying to make up a little bit of time. And so I'm wondering if anybody has any questions for our student leaders. Dean Gear, do you see any?
Hi. Sorry, I don't have my camera on it at the time. I'm not feeling too well, but my name is Kelly Jackson. I currently reside in DC, but I'm from Atlanta, Georgia. And a question I want to ask, especially for those that did not enter law school right after undergrad, can someone explain how their non-traditional or I mean, I guess everybody kind of comes from some sort of non-traditional path, but can someone explain how their path before law school, especially if you didn't immediately go into law school, kind of helped them prepare for the rigor that is expected as a law school student?
I think I can take this. Hi, Kelly. Welcome to Southwestern. I hope you join us in LA. A little warmer down here. But yeah, I didn't go to law school immediately following undergrad either. I worked in corporate sales for a while, and I, you know, I was in there for a few years. I, you know, was trying to figure out my purpose in life, and that's what kind of drove me to law school. I wanted to give back, and I knew that getting a JD would give me that ability in a more effective way. And I think that you learn a lot of skills in the workplace prior to going to law school. You learn public speaking skills. You learn what it's like to work in corporate America. You know the strenuous hours that you might have to work. And so you're going into it prepared to be an attorney after law school. And that's not to say that people going right after undergrad to law school are not able to do that, right? But you have that perspective as to you know what you're preparing for and what you're looking forward to, right? And I think that working in whatever field you work in prior to law school just gives you those basic teamwork skills, communication skills, that work ethic, and you understand what you're preparing for post graduation.
Sorry, thank you so much, Nolan. We have Nairobi, you have a question? I'm not sure if she still has her hand up. I think the next question would be from Patricia.
Yeah, I actually have the opposite question of Kelly. Oh, by the way, I'm Patricia. I'm residing in Anaheim, California. So I'm from the other side, the side that like, it's like 75 degrees all the time. And like, yeah, I had the opposite question. I'm actually a senior graduating early and planning to go to law school. So I'm graduating a year early. So I would be a third year in undergrad, but I'm actually graduating a year early. So what is it like going to law school straight out of undergrad? Because it's a little daunting, like I'm only 20 and I'm like,
do any of our student leaders want to take that question up? Yes, Angel.
Yeah, I can take it. It's weird because after high school, I actually took time to work, and then I took a few years off before I started undergrad. And I went to undergrad with the clear intention, like, you're going to law school and you need an undergraduate degree to do it. So I went to undergrad. I was super focused. I started when I was 22, and I just powered through it. I studied for my LSAT when I was in my senior year while I was working. And if you really just anchor yourself to the fact that this is really what you want to do, and that this is a career that so many other people are kept out of, that you have an opportunity to chase after and inspire, it really is motivating. You can do literally anything if you tell yourself you can do it. So I powered through. I studied for the LSAT. I took my LSATs twice when I was a senior in undergrad. I graduated. I still finished summa cum laude. Like, you can do anything if you tell yourself that you can do it. And if you believe that this is your purpose and that this is your passion. And then coming straight into law school, it was like, oh, forget everything you did in undergrad, girl. You don't write the same. You don't read the same. You don't take notes the same. And you're not held accountable the same. And so it doesn't matter if you take that break or not, is really what I'm saying, because law school is its own world. Coming into this professional program is an entirely different set of standards that you're being held to. It requires rigorous and intentional unlearning and relearning about yourself and figuring out what worked when you were in undergrad and what necessarily is not the best route for you to absorb and regurgitate this amount of information. So
I definitely think that there are advantages and disadvantages to both, but I talked to everyone and everyone was like, girl, law school is crazy. So it doesn't matter if you took the break or not, trust me.
Thank you so much, Angel. We're gonna take the next set of questions during the mix and mingle portion of our program. We're trying to make up just a little bit of time, so we are gonna move on to our next panel, but I do wanna say to our current student leaders, just thank you for everything that you do, not only for today, but just for our entire community. So thank you all. That's the true definition of leadership. So Dean Duenas, do you wanna introduce our next speaker?
Yes, thank you. So we'll now be beginning our next presentation, which is the Why Law Students Matter. We'll be featuring our legal clinic students. And I have the privilege of introducing our panel moderator, Professor Beth Caldwell. Professor Caldwell is a distinguished expert in juvenile justice and immigration law. Her scholarship has focused on gang injunctions, three strikes laws, Mexico's juvenile delinquency system, life sentences for juvenile offenders, and the consequences of deportation. Most recently, Professor Caldwell authored the critically acclaimed Deported Americans book, which provides personal accounts of the experiences of non-citizens who have been deported and offers a roadmap for more humane policy reform. Professor Caldwell also founded the Youth Offender Parole Clinic at Southwestern, and she teaches criminal law, crimination law seminar, and legal writing. So I'll turn it now over to Professor Beth Caldwell.
Thank you, and it's such a pleasure to be here with you all. As you all know, lawyers sometimes have a bad reputation, but there is so much that you can do as a lawyer to change people's lives, to fight for social justice, to challenge systems of racial subordination, and certainly to make the world a better place. So the four students that you'll get to hear from today didn't wait until they finished law school to dive into that important work. They got started in their second or third years here at Southwestern through our clinical programs. And what a clinic is it's a class where you get class credit for working with a professor or a group of professors to represent real clients in real cases. And so we'd like you to hear from a few students who've been in these clinics. I'm gonna ask you all if you could, I'll call out your name and just if you could introduce yourself very briefly and tell us a little bit about the clinic that you were involved with here at Southwestern. And I'll ask that we start with Andy Hyman.
Thanks, Professor Caldwell. I am Andy Hyman. I'm a 3L traditional day student, and I was in the Youth Offender Parole Clinic, taught by Professor Caldwell and Dean Duenas. The Youth Offender Parole Clinic, real quick, just represents the clients in the clinic are adult prisoners, but who fall under the Youth Offender Parole Law, which was passed here in California, which qualifies anybody who was under 25 years old at the time of that they committed their crime. For a slightly different kind of parole hearing that takes into account some different standards based on a series of Supreme Court cases from the 2000s. Our clients are adult prisoners in prison in California who generally have been in for quite a long time and are we represent them at their parole hearings, including preparing their briefs and conducting the hearings themselves.
Thank you. Catherine Vasquez.
Hi, everybody. I'm a 3L student and I did the removal defense clinic. So what we do is we represent clients in removal proceedings. And just as a little background, I don't want to take up too much time for anybody, but my mom was undocumented for 20 plus years. So that's part of the reason why this is a field that drew me in. I wanted to help people who were also in situations like she was. And so just helping people, you know, get documented and giving them a chance to stay in the United States was really inspiring for me. And I'm really happy that Southwestern had the clinics so that I can do that for people.
Thank you so much. Chloe Graham.
Hi, everybody. My name is Chloe. I'm a 2L traditional day student, and this past fall, I was involved with the Children's Rights Clinic. The Children's Rights Clinic is an opportunity for clinic students to represent children up to 18 in the Los Angeles Unified School District regarding special education issues, school discipline matters. We all know LAUSD is this massive network, and you know, it's the second largest school system in the nation. We're over half a million students are in LAUSD. So you can imagine if you're a student and you need special education assistance and you're not getting it, how difficult that barrier could be to break. So the Children's Rights Clinic attempts to do just that. And it's a really good opportunity if you're interested in educational rights work.
Thank you. And last but not least, Brendan Nafarate.
Hi, y'all. I'm Brendan Nafarate. I'm a traditional, a 3L traditional day student. And I was lucky enough to participate in two clinics throughout my time here. So I was in the Community Lawyering Clinic and the Appellate Litigation Clinic. The Community Lawyering Clinic is kind of a unique clinic in that it puts us as law students on the campus at Cal State Northridge to serve those students there. Primarily in their immigration needs, we'll represent them in DACA renewals, requests for evidence answers, U visas, things like that. But then also any student can sign up with us and come ask general legal questions. So, you know, I need to get custody of my children. How do I initiate a divorce? I'm going to be evicted. What are the steps I take? And we don't actually practice that area of law. So we would just provide them resources. These are the questions you ask. These are the attorneys that are available. These are the nonprofits that can help you with these things. So it's this really great way to both learn a lot about immigration law and just general legal practice and how to like listen to your clients and know what they need and be able to network out into the community so they can get what the things, get their objectives accomplished. And for the Appellate Litigation Clinic, we actually got to appeal a removal order, which is a deportation order to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. And that was really interesting for me because I came to law school to practice immigration. And seeing that overlap between criminal law and immigration was really inspiring. And our client in particular was from Central America, and I was raised by my grandparents who are from Mexico and Guatemala. So I see a lot of, you know, the issues that caused, you know, the diaspora to leave Central America, and just trying to understand those things and seeing, you know, how the practical law today affects people and, you know, can deport them. It was really difficult to see, but it was nice to know that I could give back in some way.
Thank you. Catherine, I'm going to circle back to you and ask if you could share with us one of your proudest moments in the clinic.
I think probably we had a client who was a minor, and she would always just come in with her grandma, and she always looked just very stressed out. I mean, she was a teenager who had to come to these meetings, and it was just really heartbreaking. But I think working with her over the spring semester and just really just trying to make her feel comfortable and just having conversations with her, you know, not trying to be too much in the legal, but more of, you know, just being like a person with her, just, you know, not having to ask her all these really deep questions all the time. I think just that process of being, you know, giving her that just so that she could feel safe and comfortable in that space, I think that was probably one of my proudest moments, because she did come in very just, you know, I think it's the trauma too. She was very traumatic. She was very traumatized by what she had gone through. And so just giving her that confidence to just be herself in that moment was, I think, really inspiring for me, that I was able to make that change and make her feel comfortable.
Being able to work with a sense of empathy and project that to your client is a really important lawyering skill that comes naturally when you're approaching this work from sort of that place that you mentioned, Catherine, at the beginning of sort of your family's personal experiences. So I appreciate that you're able to make that connection of how you bring that into your work as a lawyer. It makes a huge difference in how your clients relate to you and then how you can advocate. So thank you for that. Andy, could you tell us some about your proudest moment? I know a little bit more about your work since I was working with you in the clinic.
Yeah, you know, it's hard to, you know, I mean, first and foremost, the moment I was sitting there when my client got his granted parole after being in prison for 25 years. You know, hearing the parole board come out and say,
you know, after reading their whole preamble saying that, that he's been found suitable, don't find him an unreasonable risk of danger to society, and he has been found suitable for parole. And hearing him, you know, let out a gasp sitting next to me, you know, and he and I were sitting side by side. Dean Duenas was there, also sitting there, and the DA and the parole board sitting directly across from us. And just, you know, hearing the relief, you know, just that the pure sound of relief in his voice, as he gasped when he heard he was going out, you know, the stress he had been under, the fear, you know, especially knowing that this was his initial hearing and him being really afraid of his chances, of the complications of some issues in his case, you know, all of that in the months that we had spent there in prison, you know, in San Diego, you know, working on this case. Just the culmination of that, knowing that he was going to get to walk out of there, that he was going to get a chance to start a life that he had never really had a chance to start, even before he was incarcerated in this particular occasion, was something that will remain with me the rest of my life, no question about it. So that was it. But it was also sitting with him in prison on New Year's Eve in San Diego, working on his case after having spoken to Professor Caldwell and on the phone for a while and you know, kind of planned out the visit, and showing up there at the prison and waiting to be let in and hearing the guard, you know, after the guard checking my credentials, hearing them phone somebody and say on the phone, you know, hey, let them know the lawyer's here. And, you know, I didn't really want to go out of my way, say, excuse me, sir, I'm not really a lawyer. I'm a certified law student. Anyway, but, you know, just knowing that I was going to get to go in there and really work for this guy, sitting in there and, you know, huddled together, you know, in an office, trying to plan out, you know, how he could best tell the truth and best represent himself, and, you know, helping him talk through the fear of that, the fear of being authentic in front of a group of two people who were going to determine his future, and just being there with him as a, you know, a source of support was an incredibly proud moment for me as well. So those are two moments that really stand out to me as, like I said, not just singular moments from my experience in law school or my experience in this clinic, but singular experiences of my life.
Thank you so much for that. Chloe, I wanted to ask you, you know, some people might wonder how much law students can really do as advocates. And I know through the work in the Children's Rights Clinic that you can do so much. So I wondered if you might be able to share with us some of what you really can do as a law student to advocate.
Yeah, absolutely. And I had, you know, the same questions coming into law school, and especially coming into the clinic. I wasn't sure if this was something I was, you know, going to have to be filing paperwork and just making phone calls and that type of stuff, because I didn't feel as though I had the experience or the credentials really to do any legal work. That sentiment was quickly changed as soon as the clinic started, and the supervising professors, Professor Waterstone and Rodriguez Fee, really, really trust their students and train them well enough to throw them in it. So I had six clients, and we were able to draft and file due process complaints for some of them who weren't getting their special education resources that they were legally entitled to. I think one of my favorite stories that really showed me how much I could do as just a legal advocate, not even as an attorney. We had a client, and he was a 17-year-old boy who was going to turn 18 in a couple of weeks, and he was in the dependency system. So he lived in a group home, and in 2 weeks he was going to be kicked out. And he hadn't secured housing yet, and it was just a huge mess. And above all, he hadn't even finished high school. And all he wanted to do was to move back in with his mom, who wanted him to, but because of the logistics of everything, it was really hard for him to do that. And he wanted to finish high school. And within just a couple of weeks, my partner and I were able to draft a letter under an act that would allow him and says, you know, this student is legally entitled to finishing high school and having these resources. And it was a huge toss up because, like I said earlier, LAUSD has so many issues and it's so huge and so expansive and really hard to kind of break through. But long story short, they approved our letter and our client was able to move back in with his mom. And he was also able to go back to high school and he's supposed to graduate this year. So it's really cool to think that, you know, as the small part that I played as a legal advocate, I was able to get this kid to get into high school and to finish and get his diploma, which he might not have done otherwise. So there've been like really cool moments like that, that I've gotten to see in just one semester. And it really makes me feel like, okay, these clinics are actually allowing me to advocate in ways that even makes the smallest change. And it's been really empowering and also like an incredible practical experience as well.
I love that story because who knows how much of an impact that difference is going to continue to make over the course of his life. So thank you for sharing that. Brendan, do you have a story that has stayed with you from your work in either of the clinics that you could share with us?
Yes. So in the community lawyering clinic, I had a really interesting client. So it wasn't exactly a U visa. She had already applied for that. So she had come to us and told us, you know, this harrowing story of domestic violence and how she was able to get on, get out. And, you know, and now she's a full-time student raising her child alone. And she had done so many incredible things. And then the government sends us a request for evidence telling us that now the fee waiver that she applied for her U visa had been denied because she didn't qualify economically because the public benefits she was receiving were supposedly not means-tested benefits. So they couldn't determine that she was actually like below a certain economic level, right? And this was also around the time that the previous presidential administration had just released the new policy on, I guess, if you adjusted your status and you weren't reaching a certain income threshold, you know, they could also deny you for applying for residency. So with that in her mind and with all this other trauma that she was already facing, she came to us just freaking out like, well, yes, I want to send the documents I need to prove, but does this mean that I'm not going to be eligible to even move forward with my case and so on? And luckily, U visas weren't affected by that. But, you know, as a layperson, you know, this student, she didn't know that and she had a million other things going on in her life. But luckily, us as a law students and having such a great faculty behind us, we're able to, you know, analyze these new policies and show her that actually, no, the government just messed up in rejecting this. You do qualify. You will not be disqualified for these reasons. However, dealing with the Department of Social Services to get the, you know, right letter that says, you know, our client qualifies for XYZ took forever. And a request for evidence has like a limited amount of time before you are ineligible if you don't send it in. So we finally got the right document, like the day of that it had to go in the mail. And mind you, this was like, I think the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. So the mail was about to get shut down too. So we get all the paperwork we need. The client sends us her signatures. We get everything through. And then it's like 5:30. And my professor looks at me. She goes, hey, I know I'm asking a lot of you. Can you run this to UPS right now? And then this was 5:30 during the time when LA was still open. So this is pure rush hour. Everyone's trying to go home. And I'm racing from Southwestern in my car. I think it was raining. I'll pretend it was, whatever. And I'm trying to get to the UPS store. I get there. I get in the long line and the guy walks out. He goes, okay, this is the end of the line. Thanksgiving's tomorrow. I don't want to take anything else. And I was like the second to last person that got in the cutoff. And then I sent that paperwork in and yeah, you know, our client was accepted. So she didn't have to pay, you know, this crazy fee to get her U visa through, which she had already believed was going to be okay. And then, you know, everything worked out in the end, but yeah, it shows you how much lawyering is not just, you know, learning the law and stuff. It's dealing with your client, dealing with the outside world and really just doing everything you can to make sure the client's needs are met. And I'm sorry if I might have put the professor on blast by saying that I had to drive somewhere in the rain and whatever, but I hope that was okay with school policy.
Well, being an advocate goes far beyond what people imagine as being an advocate in the courtroom. And I think your story really shows that, Brendan. So thank you. You all can hear the passion with which our students approach their clinical work. You heard about meeting with a client in prison on New Year's Eve, about driving to the post office the day before Thanksgiving. But I think you can all appreciate when you really care about something, when you're working from your heart, it motivates you to do what you have to do to be there, to be a good advocate for your client. I think we're out of time for our panel, so I'll turn it back over to the facilitators, but I want to thank each of the students for sharing their experiences and for inspiring us all with your stories.
Thank you so much, Professor Caldwell, and to our amazing students. Both panels were just simply fantastic. I think it was a great choice to follow Professor Green. The comments in the chat are so moving to those of us that are watching, and we're so glad that so many of you have enjoyed today's program. And I really just appreciate the support the students give one another. It makes my job in admissions so much easier because, you know, in a race of show and tell, I think they have both shown and told you all about what makes our community so wonderful. So thank you to everybody for your participation today. It's been so tremendous. We are now joined by a few other members of our community. So we've been joined by some other faculty members. I can't see everybody on my screen all at once, so give me a second here, but I do see we're joined back by Professors Popovich and Dean Rolnick, who heads our SCALE program. I saw Professor Ramos, who is another one of our clinicians. I see Professor Longren, Professor Lutz. I hope I'm not missing anybody. Professor Rodriguez as well. So Professor Wood, I'm gonna scroll on my screen here, but you know, please, I invite you to ask any other questions that you have. We really want you to continue getting a chance to learn more about Southwestern. Oh, and I also see Professor Cameron. Did anybody have any questions regarding our two-year program? I know we had Jamie as a representative on our first panel for SCALE. Did anybody have any questions that perhaps Dean Rolnick could help you with in trying to figure out how to encapsulate your goals of law school in an accelerated format? Okay, well, Dean Rolnick, can I put you on the spot either way and invite you to share a little bit about the program with our students?
Sure, but I think did I just see Terry Cato raise his hand?
Terry, did you raise your hand? I didn't see it.
Yes, I did, but it wasn't—
Okay, go ahead.
I'm sorry. It wasn't about the SCALE program. I actually, thank you for acknowledging me. It's actually about the externship program. My question is, for evening students, how do you best incorporate an externship? Because my understanding is most of them are during the day. And for students who actually take classes at night, does that mean that to participate in an externship— I'm sorry, I'm using the wrong word, not externship, clinic.
That's correct. No, that's correct. Oh, for the clinics?
Clinics. So I used the incorrect word, I apologize. I actually mean for clinics. How do you recommend that evening students best participate in the clinics? Because it's my understanding they're offered during the day. Is that correct?
Would one of our clinical professors like to field that? Professor Ramos, how about you?
Sure. So we work with evening students. It's really just a matter of reaching out to the professor who directs that particular clinic to make sure that you can work out a schedule. So right now during the remote world, it's actually a little bit easier because we work through Zoom and our schedules are a little bit off. But even during non-pandemic world, I have worked with evening students and have just made some adjustments to the schedule. This student did have to make him or herself available through regular business hours, you know, parts of the day, but we were able to work it out. And they've had, you know, I think an equally great experience working in the clinic. And in a way, if you think about it, we serve low-income communities who often work during the day, our clients. And so oftentimes they appreciate being able to work with someone later on in the afternoon or the evening, because then you're accommodating their schedule.
Okay.
So that's a great question. Thank you for asking.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is it Angelica?
Hi, yes it is. Thank you. And please excuse my kind of weird background.
It's okay. We're all used to any background now.
Yeah. In terms of the scale program, I was curious about any, I guess, not issues or concerns from the student perspectives with, I guess, COVID or like 1Ls and doing scale in an accelerated time where it's all online.
I'm happy to start the conversation, and then Jamie, who is here, I think can share from a student's perspective, but let me start. Our incoming class this year was our largest class of 72 students, and those students have done incredibly well on Zoom for this entire first year. They will actually be completing their first year on Zoom. And I attribute it to their flexibility. The professors at Southwestern have been very flexible. I think we've all gone out of our way to make our classes engaging by breaking into small groups, by using PowerPoint, by taking, you know, tallies from the students as to their understanding. I had small groups every week in my class. I taught torts. And so I think, although we all were a little bit worried at the beginning, how will this come across? Miraculously, we've all adjusted very well to Zoom, to seeing each other in little squares or bigger squares. We've been able to read each other's faces, stay close, have study groups, have a lot of support for each other, open office hours. And so I think concerns that may have existed at the beginning really have been assuaged as we've lived through this year.
Jamie?
Yes, I agree with everything that Dean Rolnick said. I think the program has been really, really great at adapting for us. At the same time, we also have a peer mentorship program, and I think that's been really helpful, at least for my mentee. She calls me whenever she's struggling, and we're able to talk, and you know, I can share my experiences with her, and I think that's really helpful, because when I was in, I started, you know, on campus and everything, what was really meaningful for me were those interactions I had with scale twos, like in the elevators and things like that. And they were so encouraging and helpful. And so being able to create those relationships with, you know, mentees and being able to like still do that, I think really has been helpful, not, you know, for me, but also for, you know, the incoming class as well.
Awesome. Thank you guys so much. Fingers crossed for on campus.
Thank you, Angelica. Professor Rodriguez, if you wouldn't mind if I could call on you to share with our guests here today a little bit about some of your work and our Bison Bootcamp program.
Hi, everyone. So nice to see you. What a great panel. I caught the end of the remarks, and those were absolutely amazing. So first of all, we do offer a wide variety of academic support programming at Southwestern, including bar support as you near your end of your law school journey and start preparing for the bar exam. But for you now, where you are in this stage, I think that what I would emphasize are our summer academic support programs and then what we offer in the first year. All of our programming is available to all students. So the first thing I would emphasize is our Bison Bootcamp, which is free and available to all admitted students. It's a wonderful program, I think, for, I'm going to say, two primary reasons. I think where students can have a difficult time transitioning into law school is when they come to law school and try to fit what's happening in the law school classroom with what they know about undergrad. And there can be a little tension there because the environment, the how information is transferred from professor to student, or how the student even gains their own understanding of material outside of the classroom, is so different from what you're used to in undergrad. So in Bison Bootcamp, we make it a point to not only describe what that process is like, but before you're done with Bison Bootcamp, you will sit through a mock lecture with one of the professors that teach the program, so that you can really see, oh, okay, that's what's expected of me. That's how I come and I prepare for the for class discussion. And that's what class dialogue will feel like, where it's more of a question being posed by the professor, and those questions are meant to allow the students to expand on the information that they gleaned from the readings ahead of class. So that's the one. The other reason why I think Bison Bootcamp is helpful is because it gives you an opportunity to understand what law school will be like with hopefully enough time for you to start making adjustments to your life and schedule. I think that's another one of those things that students may not be as aware of is just how much time and dedication law school requires. It's not impossible. I actually think it's quite doable, but there is a lot of intentionality that goes with it. It's not enough to just simply say, you know, I'm going to study on such and such date for such and such class. It requires carving out hours so that you can dedicate to practice. Practice really is the key to success in law school. And that's something that's driven by the student, not something that someone is necessarily assigning for you to complete and, you know, making sure you're doing that work. So all of that, we really try to give you a snapshot of law school and Bison Bootcamp so you can start to identify what are some areas that maybe I need some additional assistance with. And then all of us in academic support are ready to help you even before your first day of law school. And then once you are in that, once you're here at Southwestern, we have a number of opportunities to help students feel supported. One of them, I'm seeing many of them here on this call right now, are our Dean's Fellows. These are students who did exceptionally well in law school, but more than that, they have a passion to come alongside first-year students and really help them succeed, help them achieve their own academic potential. I can't emphasize enough just what an extraordinary group of students these are. I've seen them work one-on-one with students. I've seen them work in groups settings. These students, on top of everything else they have going on, including the clinics that they're talking about here, will set aside time on a weekly basis to hold study hall sessions with their group of students so that everyone is, you know, rowing in the same direction and staying motivated even while doing all of this remotely. And then finally, I'll end with Foundations of Law and Practice, which is a course that's part of your curriculum. It's not extra, it's built right into your schedule. And the primary goal of Foundations is to not only teach you the skills you need to do well in your courses, but to pace you, right? So that you don't feel like I need to learn everything today. That would be incredibly overwhelming. Instead, we cover the substance as you need it as the semester is progressing, how to approach your readings, how to begin to organize the information, how are you tested in law school, because that's different from undergrad. So I know that was a very long answer. I hope that what you took away is that we are here to help and support you. And if what you need doesn't fit into a nice little program or course, we're here to work with you one-on-one as well.
Thank you, Professor Rodriguez. And if anybody does have a question, please feel free. You can go ahead and raise your Zoom hand or your real hand, and I will call on you. I'd like to give, Elena, you had a question. Go right ahead. You can unmute yourself.
Okay. Hi, guys. So my question, I don't know if it was answered towards the beginning of the of all of this, but it was just more about bar exam itself. So I know that California has its own separate bar exam, and there's also the UBE. And I was wondering, I know that there are probably students that take both, but just generally what you guys see your students doing, and do you all prepare them for the UBE, or how does that kind of work?
Professor Rodriguez, I know you are a data nut, so you would have all of that information, I'm sure.
Sure. Just so that everyone has an idea of what we're talking about here. So every jurisdiction has its own bar examination, and that's an exam that you take post-graduation, and it's the licensing exam. It's what you need to pass in order to become an attorney in that particular state. So California has the California bar exam. Most of our students, I would say upwards of 90%, 95% of our students will sit for the California bar exam as their first bar exam. So we have courses and programming that is absolutely designed to help you prepare for that exam. What I will also say is that what's happening in your courses from day one is also helping you prepare for the bar exam. I think that's something that I I really want students to know that from the beginning you are preparing for that exam. It isn't the separate thing that happens after graduation. What you're learning in contracts, I'm looking at Professor Popovich, that's helping you prepare for the bar because it is a bar tested subject. And the same skills that professors are testing in their own courses are tested on the exam. But we do have bar specific courses in your final year of law school and programming both during the final year and then specifically when you're studying for the exam. The UBE examination is a bar exam that multiple jurisdictions have adopted as its bar examination. So all of these states are using the same exact exam, same questions, same subjects, et cetera, et cetera. What varies will be the point value you need in order to pass the exam. With the UBE, a lot of the subjects that are tested on the UBE are also tested in California. So there's a lot of overlap. So whether you're sitting for a California exam or a UBE, the vast majority of what you're doing in law school will be applicable to passing that exam. However, if you, as you progress, if you have an idea about a different examination other than California that you are going to be sitting for, please make sure you reach out to someone in our office so that we can begin the process of advising you so that you know if there are any other requirements beyond just graduation. So as an example, in New York is now a UBE jurisdiction, but it also has its own set of requirements. Like you have to complete X number of hours before you can be licensed, even if you've passed the exam. So just helping you put some of these additional requirements on your radar would be helpful. So the earlier you know that you want to sit for a specific exam, please reach out to one of us. Our bar support is led by Assistant Dean Mary Basic, who has done a phenomenal job as far as programming and advising. So you'll be in good hands there as well.
Thank you so much. So I'd like to go ahead and see if some of our other professors that have joined us today would like to also say a brief hello and maybe let our guests know what you teach and by when they could expect to try to register for one of your classes. So Professor Wood, if you'd like to share with the group.
Oh, hello. Happy Saturday, everyone. My name is Professor Wood. I teach in the evening program, civil procedure, and I also am teaching a federal income tax. It's like an afternoon class, so it's a mix of day students and evening students. And if anyone has any questions for me about either of those subjects or the evening program. I've been teaching in the evening program for 5-6 years now. I'm gonna put my email in the chat, so.
Thank you so much. Professor Lofgren, Dean Prager.
I wanna add that Professor Wood is also an expert in American Indian law.
Yes, thank you very much. Professor Lofgren.
Hi everyone, happy Saturday as well. I teach primarily in the first year program. I teach a course called Laws, which is our legal analysis, writing, and skills class, which also has some oral advocacy components. So if you're a first year student at Southwestern in probably the day program, you have a chance of having me as your professor. And the course is required for all first year students. So whether they're in the traditional day, evening, or scale programs. It's a comprehensive course on the basic skills that you will need to succeed in law outside of a particular substantive area. These general skills like writing, good legal analysis, studying and reading cases, using the cases to prove the legal points in an advocacy setting or to evaluate the law in an objective setting. And also writing memoranda and briefs, the basic building blocks of what lawyers do in practice. And I also do some work with the SCALE program from time to time. Dean Rolnick and some of the professors have exercises where they need extra help to have enough hands to help with some exercises for the SCALE students. So I, from time to time, work with the SCALE students as well. And for myself personally, I came from a career in practice to teaching. And I bring a very practical skill set to hope to train you all as future legal professionals to step right into the profession.
Thank you, Professor. Professor Lutz. Oh, you're still on mute. Let me go ahead and unmute you.
Happy weekend, everyone. Thank you very much for this opportunity to address you. Just want to let you know that I teach in a number of areas involved in transnational and international law, both private and public international law subjects. And I mix with my courses, which are in the second and third years primarily, different skills and practical advice, as well as information about opportunities in the profession. So I look forward to interacting with a number of you, and I put my email in the chat. I do want to say too that I hope that I can get a number of students connected with other types of activities outside of their courses in a sort of a co-curriculum type of way in professional organizations in which I'm quite active in international sections and so on in both the national and state level, as well as future fellowships and so on, such as the Fulbright Fellowship and the Rule of Law Initiative that the ABA runs and so on. These are all opportunities in the international area that are available to young lawyers, and I hope I can interest some of you with respect to those. Look forward to interacting with you.
Thank you, Professor Lutz. Professor Cameron.
Hi, everybody. I teach in the first year civil procedure, which is an introduction to the civil justice system. It's a two-semester course, and traditional day students take that in the first year. Evening students take it in the second year of their study. In addition, in the upper division, I teach my specialty area of scholarly interest, which is labor and employment law, and I have a couple of courses that are hands-on skills-oriented courses. I teach a seminar. In addition, I also teach a class that straddles entertainment law and the law of the workplace. That's sports law. I teach about the sports workplace in particular. And from time to time, I teach the sports law course, not only in Los Angeles, but also in our London summer program in international entertainment and media law. And I've been there a number of times, so I can answer questions about the London program. I'm not sure we'll be going back this summer. We're prepared to if a miracle occurs and people are able to travel, but certainly in the future, I plan to be going back there. I'm also the faculty advisor to the Latino Law Students Association and also to the Labor and Employment Law Association. In that capacity, I introduce students to networking opportunities and scholarship opportunities from sources that are off campus. So there's some other things I do, but I think that's enough for now.
Thank you, Professor. Professor Popovich.
Hi, everybody. And again, welcome. I teach a variety of things. I have the privilege of following, we were talking with Professor Rodriguez about, or she was speaking earlier. I have the privilege of following her class physically in contracts first year. I'm also in the same section as Professor Cameron, trying to see if anyone else is in our section. I see some of my students, my current students, former students. In addition to teaching first year contracts, I teach upper division community property in both the scale program, and I've taught in the evening program and in the day program. I also am teaching wills and trusts as kind of a combo class in our scale program, and we have a few non-scale students in that program too. I'm trying to think, I also teach federal income tax on a few occasions. I just have to say again, really welcome. And I know sometimes the concern about being online and holding class via Zoom. I just have to say that please know that, and my students know this, that I have absolutely no less enthusiasm. I'm no less enthusiastic being online as I am in the classroom. I look forward every single day to every one of my classes, and I know my colleagues do too. And it is really a privilege teaching here. I say that because I did teach at another school, which I won't name, but it's up the Pacific Coast Highway in Malibu for some 20 some odd years. And nothing disparaging ever about that school, which I won't name, that begins with a P. But I absolutely love teaching at Southwestern. I visited a few years as a visiting professor. I've been fortunate enough for the last, this is my fourth year to be on the faculty, and I have wonderful colleagues, and most of all, the students. Again, this is diversity day. I love the diversity, and please note, you can contact me. I'm sorry I'm going on long, but I just get excited. You can contact me about anything. So please contact me. I'm happy to set up calls. My students all get my cell phone number. They can text me, call me. But please, 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 if you have any questions, I am absolutely happy to help and spend time with anyone. I'm meeting with two students tonight and two tomorrow that are not my office hours. So again, thanks for the opportunity to be able to talk. I'm sorry for talking so long, but I just, once I get it started, I get excited. I'm sorry, I can't help it. So I'll shut up and be quiet.
Thank you, Professor. Professor Ramos.
Hi, everyone. It's so nice to see everyone today on a Saturday. I teach the Immigration Law Clinic, and I'm the director of the Immigration Law Clinic program. And as you've already heard from some of the students today, the Immigration Law Clinic is just another opportunity to develop your advocacy skills. We work on writing, advocacy, working with clients, interviewing and counseling, and so many other important skills that you need to develop in law school so that when you graduate, you are practice ready and can jump right into working in really any field. All of the clinical programs are taught so that the skills that you learn are transferable to any field of practice, because they're all skills that you need as a lawyer. So it's just another way to work on these important skills with real clients, because we're not working on hypothetical cases, we're working with real clients. We work with children on a special type of law for undocumented children, as well as humanitarian cases for victims of crimes. So those are our areas of kind of focus. But I feel like I brought many, many years of practice, because before I came to Southwestern, I worked at a large public interest organization. And before that, I worked at a law firm. So I practiced law for many, many, many years. And I am really happy to be able to share sort of my knowledge and skills with students as they work to develop their skills. And I'm also the chair of the Public Interest Committee, so I'm very involved in the public interest world here in Los Angeles and work with students who want to go into that field as well. So always available to answer questions, and thank you again for being here today.
Thank you, Professor. Now let's go to Dean Rolnick, and then we'll go to Dean Garkhanian after.
Okay, well, I'm introducing myself again. I'm Harriet Rolnick. I'm dean of our two-year scale program. I've been at Southwestern since 1999 as a professor, and I graduated from Southwestern. So I can say it is true. It's a wonderful place to be, both as a student and a professor. The two-year program is very doable, despite what you may think. So I'm happy to talk with you more about it. I left my email in the chat. I teach torts in the first period of scale, which takes place in June and July, part of August. Please do not be shy in asking questions. We're all very eager to answer them and to be forthcoming with anything about which you would like to know.
Thank you. Dgarkhanyan.
Hi, everyone. Anahit Garakanyan. I've been teaching at Southwestern for 19 years. And I teach in our first year curriculum, Legal Analysis, Writing and Skills, the Laws course. I'm the faculty advisor to the Armenian Law Student Association. I'm chairing our faculty admissions committee, and I direct our externship program. So that's what I'll talk about for a minute. Externships, I mentioned before, in the world of law school, it's the same concept as internships. So this is an elective course that is super, super important to your legal education, to your job placement. And given the prominence that Southwestern has in the legal community with respect to how well we train our students for practice, our students are really sought after. So we have the largest externship program among the California ABA schools. We do about 350 externships every year. And these externships are available whether you're in the two-year JD program, whether you're a part-time student in the day, in the evening, whether you're part of the regular three-year program. Most of our students graduate having done one externship, many graduate having done two externships, and we have relationships in the public sector, in the private sector. So whether you're interested in working with a law firm, the legal department of a company, or in the public sector with public interest organizations, with judges, with government organizations. We have contacts with all of these different types of placements and send out students in the fall semester, spring semester, over the summer for these great hands-on experiences. There's a lot to learn from just being out in the field. In terms of the legal skills, the legal knowledge, but also the connections that you make, the network that you create for yourself. And this really places you in a good position with respect to applying for permanent positions after you graduate, both in terms of the skills and the knowledge that you've accumulated, but also now there are people out there, attorneys, judges who know you as a really reliable, dependable professional and want to hire you or want to recommend you to their colleague. So really, really great opportunity. I'm going to put my email information in the chat if anybody wants to reach out. I'm always meeting with prospective students to answer any questions that you might have, including specifically about externships.
Thank you, Dean Garakhanyan. Professor Rodriguez, you had a final comment about Bison Bootcamp?
Yeah, so it was I know that maybe for some students, the idea of being online is a concern, whether or not they're going to be able to engage and learn. So I did want to put a plug for Bison Bootcamp in that it is online. So if you have any thoughts about whether or not online would work for you, that's a great way to experience that. We did it online last summer, even before we knew we were going to be online in the fall semester. And it was a wonderful experience for the students. And so just my final plug, I hope I will see you in Bison Bootcamp. Come experience law school, come meet some of your future classmates, and also come meet some of our upperclassmen. The Dean's Fellows make a guest appearance. The dates for Bison Bootcamp for scale, so we do have a scale only Bison Bootcamp, and that is June 7th through the 10th. And then for our traditional programs, we have June 28th through July the 1st, and then one more August 2nd through the 5th.
Thank you. And just as a quick reminder, that program is complimentary to all of our admitted students. So it's something you can look out for once you become admitted to Southwestern. So did we have any last questions or anything for the morning? I know you've had a really full day and program. If you think of anything else that you didn't get a chance to ask today or something occurs to you, I want to encourage you to reach out to any one of the number of people who've put their emails in the chat. I'm going to leave mine as well again for you. So if I can help in any way, during your time as an applicant, please feel free to reach out to me. And I want to thank our wonderful panelists, from Professor Green to our student panel that Deans Mena and Duenas moderated, to the wonderful clinical panel that Professor Caldwell moderated, and all of our students that shared their time, and our professors that also shared a little bit of their beautiful Saturday. It ended up being a beautiful Saturday here in Southern California after the rainy days that we've had. So much appreciation to everybody and to all of our guests that have spent their mornings with us. We hope you had a great opportunity to learn a little bit about what makes Southwestern special. I think this was just a small taste, and hopefully you'll join us for some future programming. All of our events are listed on our admissions site as well. So I'm going to drop that for you, and we hope to see you again. And I hope you all stay safe and stay healthy. Take care, everyone.